Right. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the Florida Coastal Resilience Technical Workshop presented by the Florida Silver Jackets. My name is Kip Weber. I'll be the lead facilitator today. We also have has a couple conflicts, but Matt Schrader will also be calling in when he can to help assist with the virtual facilitation. Both Matt and I will be keeping track of the chat, keeping tabs on any questions asked during the presentation. We just started the recording, and we are recording this workshop today so that you or other coworkers can go back and look at this content, or if you have to drop off for another conflict. We know everybody's busy, so the recording is available if you miss any of today's material. So we won't be doing introductions for everybody on the call, but if you would, to see who is on, please type your name, organization in the chat, as well as where in Florida you are and who you represent. This morning, we sent out the PDF presentation of the content that we'll cover today to provide the option to follow along at your own pace, but also to serve as a guidebook or a future reference when using these tools. So if you haven't received this presentation, either you just registered or for some reason didn't receive, please send me an email. I'll put my email in the chat shortly and we can send you this, or you can send me a private message and we'll cover how to do that on the next slide. All right, so hopefully most people are able to attend the regional workshop. So we're just gonna, you've already seen this, but we're just gonna quickly highlight some of the main functionality to use during the workshop today through the WebEx platform. First is that mute and unmute function. So be aware of that dreaded double mute. That's when both your computer and your phone are muted. And in order for us to hear you, we have to, you have to have both those unmuted, for the voice to come through. If we are hearing background noise, we may have to mute everybody. And if we do this, you have to hit *6 to unmute, but we don't expect this to be an issue with this audience today. Cameras and video. So I have my camera on right now. And for the presenters, we encourage you, for the introductions and Q&As, to turn your cameras on. And for the audience members, if you're asking a question, feel free to turn your camera on when asking. But overall, in an effort to save bandwidth, we do ask that you keep your cameras off unless you are presenting or asking a question. If you want to see who's on the call today, you can click the participants tab and look at the list of others that are on the call. And then finally, the chat function, which is probably the most important function for the workshop today, where we see people entering their names and organizations in the chat, so we appreciate that. And we'll be using the chat today to track questions and comments, but also we'll be placing links to the tools as well as background information in the chat. So be sure to keep track of that chat function today. And as we talked about, if you have a specific question or haven't received that PDF, you can use that drop-down arrow in the chat and send a private question to myself, but as well as anybody else on the chat. So that's a cool feature that we have today. So a quick background on what the Silver Jackets is. So the Silver Jackets program as a whole is under the National Flood Risk Management Program of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. It's a partnership across state, federal, tribal, and local agencies to leverage expertise for specific goals related to managing flood risk. It's a nationwide program, and each state has their own Silver Jackets team. The Florida Division of Emergency Management is the state lead for the Silver Jackets team. And today, Ian Olin from FDEM is joining us as the state lead, and I want to introduce Ian and allow him to make some opening comments for the workshop. So, Ian.
Hey, thanks, Kip. Hey, good morning, everyone. My name is Ian Olin from the Florida Division of Emergency Management. Really want to thank everyone for joining today for the technical workshop. And for those of you who've previously participated in either of the regional workshops, thank you for coming back. Really want to, big shout out to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, Kip, Matt, and others, as well as all of the other various state and federal agencies, as well as the University of Florida, for those who contributed to these workshops and made them such a success. There's a great lineup of presenters today, and look forward to hearing from everyone. Thanks, Kip.
Yeah. Thanks, Ian. And yeah, appreciate you and your whole division's support of Silver Jackets and this effort. So appreciate that. And as Ian said, you know, there were many state and federal agencies that have partnered to bring you the material for all these workshops. And we'll give a shout out in a couple slides here. So outline last slide, the training is a Florida Silver Jackets initiative to increase community resilience with the goal to share information, knowledge, and tools to increase coastal resilience posed by coastal storms and sea level rise to a target audience that includes local, county, and regional planners, engineers, and really anyone involved in coastal resilience workshop. The technical workshop today is really targeted for both planners and also an emphasis on those engineers to get some modeling applications and user inputs for some of the tools that we'll highlight today. So quick recap of those regional workshops that have already been conducted. There were two regional workshops, one targeted for the Gulf Coast and the other for the East Coast of Florida. The workshops were each 3 days, 3 hours each day, and centered trainings on those state of Florida laws and requirements associated with coastal resilience, then provided background and basic training on those publicly accessible tools and resources to be used within the context of state statutes to assess, communicate, and address risk in order to facilitate compliance. Then the agencies provided hands-on training with the tools developed, and the applied exercises took that language from those Florida laws and requirements and demonstrated ways to use the tools to comply. These presentations for both the Gulf and Atlantic were similar, but the applied exercises were geared more towards those respective coastlines and communities. The logos on the right of the screen show the participating agencies. So I wanted to give a quick shout out to all the partnering agencies from the state side, consisting of the Florida Division of Emergency Management, the Department of Economic Opportunity, Department of Environmental Protection, Department of Transportation, and the University of Florida GeoPlan Center. And then from the federal side partnering were NOAA, EPA, and the Army Corps of Engineers. All partnered to bring you this effort. So before we dive into the technical workshop today, wanted to open a quick poll here just to see if you have, if you are able to participate in those regional workshops, or if this is the first time you've been able to participate today. So we'll give it about 30 seconds to answer. Just want to get an overall look at were you able to attend, and this is supplementing, or are you really focused on those engineering components of the CHS and other tools that we'll be covering today that wasn't covered in the regional workshops. So a couple more seconds and we'll close it out. Looks like we have almost 60% finished, so that's a good number. So we'll go ahead and close it out in the next 5 seconds here. All right, and hopefully you should be able to see that those poll results. So it looks like the majority of people said yes, but not all 3 days. About 9 people out of the 32 responses were able to participate in all 3 days. 7 weren't able to participate at all. So good mix. And this is good feedback that some people were able to attend all of them, but some people missed a day, and that's okay because these are recorded. They will be posted, so you can go back at a later date and watch the days that you missed. And we'll get more into that at the end of the workshop today. All right, so let me just save this question real quick. Right. So the purpose of this technical workshop today takes a couple of those tools presented during the regional workshops, takes a deeper dive into these tools and how they can be used for specific site application or modeling purposes. So there was a little snafu this morning, and we'll get into that quickly. But so we were originally going to present the coastal hazard system first, but Murphy's Law prevailed, and we're now going to start with NOAA's tool. But just so as I'm going through these workshop objectives are switched today in terms of the order, but I'll just go through how it is on the screen, and then just know that we'll be starting with NOAA today. So the one tool is the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and Engineer Research and Development Center, or ERDCS, Coastal Hazard System Tool, which was developed through the South Atlantic Coastal Study, or the SACS. Then the second tool is the NOAA Adapting Stormwater Management for Coastal Floods, developed through the NOAA Office for Coastal Management. And so we could have gone into more detail on all the tools presented during the regional workshops. So why are we highlighting these tools? And the short answer is that these tools are relatively new and fresh off the press, as they say. The Coastal Hazard System, or CHS, was a product of the SACS, which has been in development for several years. And during the SACS workshops conducted in 2019 and 2020, we were able to brief on most SACS key products, but the CHS was still under development at that time, and we weren't able to present on it. So one of the main purposes of the technical workshop is to teach and demonstrate this coastal hazard system and how planners and engineers can assess the CHS high fidelity numerical modeling, which couples the hydrodynamic and waves when designing and planning flood risk management projects. The second tool was identified during the planning process for the Silver Jackets Regional Workshop, and that's the NOAA Adapting Stormwater Management for Coastal Floods tool. So the second objective is to teach and demonstrate this tool to analyze stormwater system for scenario development based on user input. And this tool has been around for a couple of years, but it was recently updated based on some feedback, and this is the first time NOAA will be providing an in-depth demonstration of this tool since the update. And we've seen, you know, from those recent storms, just how important those stormwater systems are for managing flood risk. So we're very excited for both these modules being presented today. I want to quickly point out that there are training credits available for participation in this workshop. There are continuing education credits available for certified floodplain managers for today, as well as American Institute of Certified Planners, or AICP, certification maintenance credits available. Credits are awarded based on attendance and participation, so to be sure to stay engaged in the chat and the polls throughout the trainings as able. Here's a super quick technical workshop. As I said, you know, these have been switched, but really going to highlight those two tools. I will take a 10 to 15 minute break in between and then wrap up the workshop, point out where those presentations and recording will be housed so everybody can access those in the future. And with that, I will pass it to Josh Murphy, who from NOAA, who will go over his tool, NOAA's Adapting Stormwater Management for Coastal Hazards. Coastal Floods. I'm sorry. Yeah, Coastal Floods.
No worries. Hey, it's all good. Yep. Although you had to mention Murphy's Law, didn't you? We could have said it was more about us being resilient or what have you, but no, I appreciate it. We're certainly we appreciate everyone's flexibility this morning as we switch things up on you just a little bit. So, all right, let me go ahead and I'm going to share my screen. And again, I appreciate your patience as we share our screens this morning. As we all know, these systems are all just a little bit different. So let's see here. Excellent. Okay. So you all should be seeing my screen now. Wonderful, thanks, Kip. Appreciate it. Again, good morning, everyone. My name is Josh Murphy with the Office for Coastal Management out of our office with NOAA headquarters in Silver Spring, Maryland. Want to echo my thanks to the Army Corps of Engineers and the Silver Jackets program for the opportunity for NOAA, my colleagues in the Office for Coastal Management, to participate in these workshops. And you know, I know we originally had this product second in the queue this morning, but I actually feel like it might do a little bit better in this spot. You know, I think you'll see as we go through this that this is something that we've really tried to bridge the gap a bit between some of the more technical folks in our constituency and others. We work with a broad base of constituents, not just the nation's coastal management community, but the land use planners, the transportation planners, the hazard planners, floodplain managers, and the like. And so when we design products and services, while we try to make them as targeted as possible, we recognize that there are certain issues that themselves are broadly applicable and demand a broad response. And so as you'll see this morning, this is, again, a wonderful opportunity. As Kip mentioned, we have been designing this a little bit differently for a product in our office over the last couple of years. I think this product does a really good job of demonstrating NOAA's commitment to what we call service delivery. And that means that we really interface first with our constituents, all of you here on this call, to identify what the issue may be that maybe we're not quite hitting very well. Where are those information gaps that we can help fill with NOAA scientific data and information? From there, then develop a product, which we developed the first part of this product back in 2018, Adapting Stormwater Management for Coastal Floods. We heard from our constituents that this notion of comminatory coastal flooding, that communities in the Southeast and the Gulf predominantly, but all across the country, were having issues more predominantly and more frequently, where they were having some pretty significant rainstorms at the same time that they were having an extreme coastal water level event. And it was really impacting the ability of some of their coastal facing service areas and catchments to really effectively manage their stormwater. And so it really caught us in our office to really kind of figure out how we might want to address this. And so what you see today is kind of the manifestation of that, recognizing that we put out the original product in 2018. And then we kind of did a lot more listening, and we worked with a couple different communities to include a Florida community, Hallandale Beach, to really review and ground truth the product that we had put out the door and use that information and the feedback that we got through some of the workshops. Olympia, Washington was the other community, to enhance the product. And so what you see today is really the genesis of about 3 to 4 years of kind of constant, in-reach, outreach, needs assessment, product development to get where we are today. And as Kip mentioned, this is the first time that we really have the opportunity to provide a little bit more of a deep dive. As you'll see, this is a pretty comprehensive information resource, a learning product, if you will. And so we are excited to share it with you this morning. All right. So some of you may have seen this. We did a little bit of an overview for this in the regional workshops. And so some of this, the very first sections here are going to be a little bit of a repeat there, but I think it's important for those who are new and even for those of you who saw this before to get a good sense for really what this project entails, again, because it is very comprehensive by design. We're going to do a quick applied exercise with one portion of this, and then what we're really going to focus on this morning is this deep dive into what we call the analyze section. This is what we spent a good portion of time between 2018 and 2021 redoing, rethinking, listening to ensure that we can produce something that is really broadly applicable across the coastal zone to some of the larger constituencies that we work with and some of the smaller communities that we work with. And again, we'll cover that as well. And then finally, we'll provide you with the opportunity to learn more. We're going to have some polls along the way to get you guys to interact with us. And then we'll also ask some questions that we will hope that you will interact with us via the chat. And it's important to note that the chat is always there. If you have a question, I'll frequently pause to check the chat to see what questions you may have, but feel free to put those in there and we'll try to get them addressed for you. And my contact information will appear at the end of the presentation if you'd like to follow up and provide and to ask more questions or to learn more about the product, right? So we're going to start with a poll question here. So I'm going to read this out and then I'm going to pass the baton back over to Kip so that he can actually launch the poll in itself. But I'm curious to know a little bit about the folks who are here on the presentation today. So I want you to choose the title that best describes your current position. Maybe you're a stormwater manager, engineer, emergency manager, land use planner, floodplain manager. I recognize that some of you wear several different hats, so choose one. You may also choose other on here. And if you do that, if you wouldn't mind just kind of maybe putting in the chat what you would best describe as the hat that you wear within your current position. So Kip, if you want to take things back here and we'll start this poll.
Yeah. Let's see, should be right. There's the question. And then opening the poll now, should be able to respond.
Excellent, thank you. So again, folks, don't forget to choose the question, hit submit, and then again, if you choose other on here, that please, after you submit the question, if you want to put what you would best describe as your current position in the chat. Thank you, Eddie, for demonstrating that.
All right, we're about at 60%. So a couple more seconds, and there we go, near 65 now. I'm gonna go ahead and close. And then you should be able to see the results.
Excellent, right? So some folks we've got, for those who answered and identified one of the options that we have, I think a good portion identified themselves as stormwater managers and engineers. That's great. As you'll see, you're certainly one of our target audiences, but we also have folks that identify themselves as either emergency managers, land use managers, floodplain managers, and then we've got what I can see in the chat are a lot of chief resilience officers, adaptation officers, natural resources specialists. So that's great, and certainly we appreciate it. I think there's going to be something for everyone in this session this morning. So again, this is helpful for me to know a little bit more about who you are and where you come from. So I will share my screen once again, and again, thanks for y'all's patience as we do this. Okay, excellent. Okay. So again, one of the things that I really like and appreciate about the way in which these workshops are structured is the fact that there is this, we're trying to draw a direct line of sight to some of the different laws and statutes in the state of Florida that you can kind of leverage and that these products provide information for. And so from where I sit, this is just my take on where I see some alignment and or intersection points with some of the many different laws and policies and regulations that you have in the state, to include the, in this case, the Peril Flood Act here. And this is because this one basically looks at in the language here, the verbiage, it talks about reducing flood risk in coastal areas, which results from high tide events, storm surge, flash flood, stormwater runoff, and related impacts of sea level rise. So this speaks to the kind of this comprehensive notion of this product and the ability to kind of think about what we call a total coastal water level scenario that may incorporate any and all of these different risks occurring coincidentally. So this is certainly something I feel could look to serve this particular regulation. The State Flooding and Sea Level Rise Resilience Plan, again, we see in the language here, the depth up to the extent practicable compound flooding or the combination of tidal, storm surge, and rainfall and reduced flooding. So you'll see how you can use this learning product today to be able to start to estimate what, you know, and quantify what some of this information provides. Okay. And then the SLIP standards, looking at this notion of looking at the contribution of sea level rise, relative local sea level rise, or what have you. Again, this is a product that really looks at the contribution of sea level rise to all these other different drivers of coastal flooding in itself. All right. So that's just, again, trying to make that more explicit linkage, which I think is very valuable and something that I think we should start to look at nationwide as we pull these kind of workshops together, because in my opinion, that makes this information a little bit more meaningful if we can start to draw these direct line of sights to some of the laws, policies, and regulations at the state, local, and wherever we can national level for this. So what is this product? By now you might be going, huh, okay, so he's talked abstractly about this. What is this product that we've got on here? So this is, we think of it internally within our office as a learning product, and you'll see why today. It really does provide a section that provides a guided methodology for walking someone through the process of developing a future coastal total water level scenario, and then actually calculating an estimate of that coastal total water level, and then optionally comparing that to some components of their stormwater infrastructure. But it goes a little bit even beyond that. And what we really tried to do in developing this product, again, because we've really been taking the long view with it, starting in 2018, and then, you know, getting user input at the very beginning, validating that user input through some community workshops. And what that has resulted in is something that's what we like to also refer to as kind of beyond just a learning product. It's an integrated collection of information resources. And you'll see that there's four sections of this product that really start at just, you know, addressing what are some of the drivers of coastal inundation? How does this matter to stormwater engineering? The second section is an actual automated tool to provide information that can help someone better understand when they might be, their community may experience different total coastal water levels and high tide flooding day durations. And then we have an analyze section that is really geared towards working to provide information that can be useful for really starting to quantify that coastal total water level. And then finally, a section at the end that really provides a lot of information on some of the different actions that a community can take. So you see here, and Kip put Kip put the URL into the chat here. That is the URL, and we'll provide this several different times through here. There are a couple different inputs that you will see that I'll give a little bit more information on a little bit later on. Some of these are going to be broadly accessible to any and all. Some of them are going to be a little bit more boutique. And again, we will cover those as we get through it. And so that's important to note that there's, you know, there is going to be some input and information that we'll be able to, you'll be able to get from a variety of different sources. Some of it, again, may be something that is specific to your community. So what do you get out of this? Well, two different things. There's a report that kind of really provides information in something in a form that is easy to read and understand, looking at the timing of flood threshold elevations and high tide flooding frequencies. And then there's a separate report in the analyze section that provides an assessment of potential future coastal flooding impacts on stormwater infrastructure. So we'll look at both of those today. Again, we put this out the door in 2018, and then we revised it and put the version 2 out the door last summer with this enhanced analyze section that we'll walk through today. This is a web-based software, so all you need is a web browser and an internet connection to be able to run, and there's no special permissions needed. However, and again, this is something that I'm going to really try to emphasize as we go through this, there is a fair amount of flexibility that has been built into this product to make it more accessible to all, to communities large and small. But what you put into it is going to impact and affect what you can get out of it. And some of it is going to necessitate really having some specific data and information on your community's stormwater system. Now, that's not to say that the if you don't have that, that you aren't going to be able to get value out of this. And I'll show you how you can today. But do note that and to get the finest amount of detail from a product like this means that your community is going to really need to have a stormwater model. This product does not teach a community how to better manage their stormwater, to be sure. What it does is it provides information that can help a community better understand how to effectively plan for a coastal water level. It could be used as a boundary condition in, say, a stormwater model if your community has it, or if your community doesn't have a stormwater model, then it provides information that can be used to estimate the impact of, say, an overtopping event at the same time you have a coincident precipitation event. All right, so our target audience here, primarily stormwater managers and engineers. Now, again, that's not to say that if you aren't a stormwater manager or an engineer, that there isn't information that could be broadly applicable to you. And so certainly we've tried to also provide information in this product in such a way that it could really speak to public works officials, land use planners, floodplain managers. So you see why I asked that question up front, but really anyone who has the need for examining future flood conditions against critical coastal elevations. And what we're finding is we're constantly putting this out the door and listening to the feedback that we get from folks on this is that folks are really seeing this as a great opportunity to the piece that we'll talk about today with regard to the derivation of a coastal total water level certainly has broader applications and implications beyond just the kind of comparing it to some critical stormwater elevations. So just something to point out here. Okay. So this product again has 4 different sections. I've already kind of gone through this. The first one, understand, is more of kind of just a, you know, provides a body of knowledge on the different types of coastal flooding. Quick flood assessment tool, or the assess section, is an automated, it's the most automated portion of the product that allows you to provide some simple inputs and derive some outputs that really speak to the timing of when your community may experience certain elevated water levels, coastal water levels in the future. Analyze is what we're going to focus on today. It provides a methodology, a detailed methodology, and a process for capturing information as we walk through a workflow to really be able to create a coastal total water level scenario and then derive a coastal total water level from that. Then compare that to your stormwater systems elevations. And then finally, we have a section here at the end, take action. We didn't want to develop a product like this that, you know, that may result in a community recognizing that they may have significant issues in the future without providing maybe some you know, information on some steps that they could take to address that in the future as well. All right. So the understand function, this again, this is a section that is more informational in nature. It really kind of outlines the different types of coastal flooding. What are those big contributors? The regional oceanographic drivers that we see that varies from region to region and throughout the seasons as well. The high tide flooding, the extreme high tide water levels that we see, rainfall certainly from precipitation-based flooding, the storm surge, wind and waves, all of that are different drivers or contributors to coastal flooding. And you see here on the right, there's a little kind of interactive portion of this that folks seem to really like that kind of speaks to risk communication and to try to kind of communicate the issue at hand here, that it's not just thinking about these different types of and drivers of coastal flooding individually, but with sea level rise and with these event-driven coastal flooding elements occurring more frequently, that we have to start thinking about how we might plan for those occurring coincidentally. And concurrently, which means that that in turn will elevate a future coastal total water level. And then so we also provide information here on considerations for certainly the stormwater management community, but also the broader implications for floodplain managers, land use planning, public works, depending on the scope and scale of the issue at hand here, you know, how much that coastal total water level that you estimate using this product, what might be some considerations that really are go beyond, say, just the stormwater management community and demands a whole of community approach, right? So let's see here, just based off of that, I'm gonna hand this back over to Kip for this next poll question. Which type of flooding in your community, because this is a community driven question, certainly, which type of flooding concerns you the most? And I recognize that some of y'all in Southeast Florida are a little bit waterlogged and soaked. Rainfall runoff certainly might be top of mind, but it could be rainfall runoff, high tide flooding, riverine flooding, storm surge, or all of the above. So I just want to, again, kind of get a sense for what really moves the needle. And again, it may be that you're someone from Public Works that really is more concerned about high tide flooding in the near term than, say, something that may be a little bit less episodic. So Kip, if you want to take this back and let's get to the second poll question here, I'd appreciate folks providing your input here.
Right, poll should be open.
Skip. Again, purely subjective answer. And I recognize that, it may be kind of it may be hard to choose, but just again, so I can kind of try to get a bit of a sense if it everything. Is there something that's particularly acute concerning to your community? And again, that's going to be based on your community's location amongst many other different factors. So.
All right. Yeah, we got about close to 70%. So I'll close the poll.
All right.
And then you should be able to see the results.
Excellent.
Can you see him, Josh?
I cannot. Here we go. Okay. Thank you. Yeah, no, I got it here. Four of the participants said rainfall runoff, 7 high tide flooding, no one with riverine, which is not too terribly surprising in the state of Florida. 8 with storm surge, certainly, and then a good portion all of the above. And again, that is kind of what we've heard from a lot of different folks, and why we pulled this product together was because that, folks are starting to recognize that there's, we can't start thinking about some of these kind of individually, and that we really need to start thinking about how we might plan for and address them in the future coincidentally. So let me share my screen again. Okay, excellent. Okay. So the quick flood assessment tool is the second part of this. This is something we went over in the regional workshops here. This is meant to be, as the name suggests, something that's really kind of quick and provides information to help address a question we get a lot in our sea level rise work. And it's kind of, all right, if there's a certain amount of sea level rise or a certain maybe there's a water level threshold in your community that you plan for. Maybe it's that line in the sand at which you know that if it's exceeded, that you start to have damage to life or risk to life or property. This product is meant to kind of incorporate information from NOAA's sea level rise projections that we do with our federal colleagues. And so basically what it does is it uses information that we get from our colleagues at NOAA Tides and Currents, or the Center for Operational Oceanographic Products and Services, So it helps you find the closest tie gauge for which we have information. And you may note as you go through here that there's a couple tie gauges are missing. Most notably, I noticed Fort Lauderdale. There's one, I believe, there that is not included because we don't have all the information using the sea level rise report for that one. But once you find that, it will then ask you for a coastal flood threshold elevation. It will then ask you for what we refer to as a high tide flooding days threshold. This is a number of days of high tide flooding that, you know, that's kind of like your line in the sand temporally. So let's say that, you know, you know that right now your community can, you know, maybe they experience about, you know, 10 to 12 days of high tide flooding annually, and that at that point you can handle it, you can mitigate it. But maybe if you go above that to say 15, 18, 20, it becomes a little bit less of a nuisance and more of a real issue for your community. So this is meant to kind of, again, provide a temporal threshold. And then you choose, we have just recently updated this product to incorporate the 2022 sea level rise technical report and some of the projections there. But we recognize that certain areas, and including the state of Florida, still mandate the use of the 2017 technical report. So we provide the user to choose that on here. What this gives you is a report that you see here on the right-hand side that allows you to kind of take a look at kind of the current recurrence interval of the flood threshold elevation, say that five times fast, that you have entered in here. And then it allows you to kind of take a look at, and you know, kind of all the different scenarios related to the sea level rise projections that you chose to start to get a better handle as to when, thanks to sea level rise, you would hit that threshold with the high tide every day. You know, we also recognize that there's going to be impacts that are going to occur before that that time period. And so we also provide information as to what amount of sea level rise it would take for that chosen flood threshold elevation to basically become the same, have the same recurrence interval as the 100 or the 10-year recurrence interval that you may be used to working with in your community. And then finally, we also provide a sense of when you might expect to reach your high tide flooding days thresholds. Now, I will note about this that even if you choose 2022 as the sea level rise set of projections for this, that currently right now the high tide flooding days threshold still pulls from the data from the 2017 report. And that's explicit within the output of this product itself. I just want to kind of mention this right now. We're working with our colleagues in the Center for Operational Oceanographic Products and Services to update this. And I anticipate that we will push that out with the next update of this product. I'll also note that our colleagues at Tides and Currents are also moving towards a gridded solution for providing information on sea level rise and extreme water levels outside of the closest tide gauge. And so we're also working with them, and that may be an enhancement that you see with this product in the future. We'll come back to that in just a second, but I do want to basically provide you all right now with the opportunity, if you have the ability to, and I recognize that sometimes this takes a little bit of screen juggling on here, to be able to generate your own report from this product. Again, this is meant to be kind of a quick, so I'm going to do this at the same time here as maybe some of you guys are. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to take my screen, and I am going to divide it up here so that these slides can sit on the left and I can go on the right here. And feel free to follow along with me. And in fact, I kind of encourage you if you have the ability to do this. So what I'm going to do is if you start, you can go directly using this this URL. Will take you directly to the assess portion. But if you use just the base URL for this product, or if you Google it, it'll take you to our homepage here where you can get to all four of the different sections. I'm going to choose the assess section here to get started this morning. Okay. So this takes you to the first page here. Now I'll note what's nice about this is that you can take this output report and you can print it out as a PDF or, you know, printed sheet of paper, or as long as you don't clear your browser cache, you can view, it will save your previous assessment. Now it saves it, it is local in your browser. We don't collect any of the information from this. So if you did clear your browser cache, it wouldn't be available again, but that is just something to note that you can view a previous assessment. I'm gonna start a new assessment here, okay? First thing it does, step one, is it asks you to enter in your community. We use a gazetteer here to kind of help you out. I'm gonna use Hallandale Beach today because we worked with them and have a lot of appreciation for the input that they provided to this product back in the workshop that we did with them in 2019. So I'm gonna choose Hallandale Beach, Florida. What this is gonna do is it's then going to, using Euclidean distance, it's going to find the closest the closest tide gauge that has data and information that was used that we can use within this report. And that means, and I've talked to some of our sea level rise gurus, that you may note that there's a couple that are missing from this map. There's one I know certainly at Virginia Key. There's one up in Fort Lauderdale. So again, not everything is on here. We're going to kind of use the closest one. In the chance that you're in a different location and you find that there is, say, like another a tide gauge that you may want to use that's kind of equally distant or close to your community, you certainly can choose that. You can select one. This just kind of does an automatic selection, but you can override that if you'd like. All right, and that tide gauge is important, again, because we use the information from the closest tide gauge, at least currently, before we have a gridded product to pull this information. So then what we have here on the right is we incorporate information from our sea level rise viewer here. And this is something that could be useful just from a visual purpose. If, say, you wanted to be able to, say, elevate the water level here to give yourself kind of a visual representation of maybe an elevation threshold. Now, this is at 1 foot increments. If you wanted to, you could certainly use what's called the advanced view. It will take this slider away. You can then choose what datum you want to choose, whether it's in this case a tidal datum, mean high or high water, or an orthometric NAVD88 in feet or meters. And then note that you can then enter in your threshold a little bit more precisely using the controls here. So I'm going to do, say, 2.9 feet of sea level rise here. Right. The next thing it asks you for, if we go over here to step three, is the number of high tide flooding days. What you see here on the right is a map, again, pulling from our sea level rise viewer, that brings in these areas in red are areas that flood whenever there's a shallow coastal flooding advisory that's issued by the National Weather Service. So this kind of gives you that notion of which areas are flooding when we have a high tide flooding event. So here again, and we have no prescriptive kind of guidance on this one other than to say it really varies as to, what is your tolerance for high tide flooding. We provide information here in 2019, there were 9 high tide flooding days, so it's a couple of years behind, I recognize, but maybe, maybe you feel pretty good, you don't have a lot of impacts and you recognize you can manage it and maybe you feel like if you go above 24 days a year in which you have a high tide flooding event, that's really where you're going to start to see a lot of issues, right? So the next thing it asks is to select a sea level rise projection here. Again, this is a new portion of this product we integrated. We wanted to provide, we didn't just want to force a community to consider the latest sea level rise projections from the 2022 report, recognizing that we have had the 2017 report out there. And so this provides an opportunity for you to choose which one you'd like to see, 2017 or 2022. On here, and so you can choose these projections and click finish. And what that does is it gives you again this kind of this report that's meant to take this information as an output and put it into kind of plain language here. So, kind of reporting both your flood threshold elevation in both meet reference to a tidal datum, mean high or high water, and then also a vertical datum here, and then kind of reporting what you put in here. Putting that into this notion of what's the recurrence interval for that water level threshold that you had, but then when would that occur daily? And again, kind of trying to consider these different scenarios coming from the latest sea level rise projections. And so again, kind of allowing you to choose which scenario, and then kind of when you would then experience that to when that water level would occur basically every day with the high tide. But then also kind of putting it into the context of how much sea level rise would it take to basically make this into a 100 year the same recurrence interval as a 100 year event or what have you. In this case, it would only take about a little bit more than a half a foot of sea level rise. So trying to kind of put this information into some flood thresholds that may be a little bit more commonly used. And then finally, again, recognizing that the data to this point, since I chose 2022, is coming from the 2022 sea level rise technical report. This down here still uses the data from 2017, and we will send out a big kind of outreach blast when we update this in the near future with information from the 2022. But you see with 2017, basically 24 days is what I entered in for high tide flooding. It would put this in at around 2030 or so. So that's the quick flood assessment tool. One thing that I'd like to know first is I'll pause in just a second for questions, but while we're taking some questions and seeing what you have here, I'd love to see if you guys have worn through this, kind of maybe what you got out of this, what you put into this. So using the chat, if you want to care to, if you've used this, if you've walked through this to kind of share some information from your analysis here, your community name, what flood threshold elevation you chose, the sea level rise scenario, in what year you'd expect to experience that elevation. So just thinking about the elevations in this case. So you see an example here, you know, of this information. I'd be curious to know, but we'll also pause and see if we have any questions.
Hey, Josh, I don't see any questions in the chat as of now, but if anybody is interested, feel free to raise their hand and you know, you can come off mute and ask a question, or feel free to put your question in the chat if you have any at this time. And then in the meantime, just put that what's on the screen in the chat. So use that information and then you know, enter the answer similar to the example for Hallandale in the chat.
Thanks, Kip. And then I recognize how are we doing on time here? I feel like I've got to about 10:15 or so.
Yeah, anywhere between 10:15, 10:30. So you're yeah. Doing great on time.
Excellent. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Oh, you have one question from Heidi.
I see that.
Josh,
yeah,
can you
I do.
Say one? Okay.
Yeah. Thanks, Kip. Yeah. No, I'll let you read that from here on out. Yeah. So thank you, Heidi, from this. So just so there's no confusion, and again, we've tried to put it in here. Instead of kind of waiting on the extreme water levels information, we chose to go ahead and put this out, but with the 2022 update of the sea level rise technical report. So basically, if you choose the 2022 sea level rise projections here for this, then that is used for the flood frequency tomorrow section. So taking your flood threshold elevation and then kind of, you know, comparing that to the different scenarios. This comes from 2022, right? This is from the 2022 sea level rise technical report. You see that here and certainly all through it here in the captions for the figures. It also comes into play here in this next section of the flooding extreme. So kind of looking at the, you know, comparing how much sea level rise would it take to match the 100 year or the 10 year to the same, you know, recurrence interval of the current of your flood threshold elevation. So this also comes from the sea level, the sea level 2022 report. But then basically it is this last section here related to high tide flooding that is still pulling from, in this case, you see here in figure 5 of the 2017 sea level rise technical report. So recognizing, you know, basically, you know, using and recognizing that that's going to be a little bit different in the short term. And again, we will update that. And when it does, we will push that out to you. So good point and good question there.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Heidi. Thanks for that response, Josh. No other questions, so we can continue. But for the audience members, just keep thinking of questions and put them in the chat as we go along, and we'll circle back to them when we have another Q&A break.
Thank you. So the analyze section we're gonna go through in depth. So I'm not gonna cover this here. But one thing is the take action section that I will. While I've got this split screen set up here, we'll go ahead and move through this. So again, one of the things we wanted to do to make this as comprehensive as possible is not just provide information for communities to kind of assess what their risks may be to future coastal flooding, but also recognizing that the responses dependent on the scale and the scope of what you learn in this product may go beyond what we traditionally think of, say like the on the ground best management practices or BMPs, things to manage stormwater, say on the site. It may really kind of you know, demand a whole of community approach that considers not just those traditional on the ground measures, but also regulation, standards, guidance, maybe some planning considerations, as well as then, you know, certainly the you know, the proverbial $64,000 or $64 million or probably higher than that question is funding. Where can I get that? So we've tried to provide all this together into kind of just a comprehensive resource that kind of provides a lot of this close at hand, as well as a couple of different case studies as we have on here, and just some kind of considerations, right? Some questions you would need to think about if you're kind of taking what you've learned from this product and starting to kind of think about, you know, what are those considerations related to timing, spatial scale, risk management approach, adaptive management, and community support, right? So kind of considering all of this and kind of putting in this notion of how you might move forward, and that may consider planning, right? So how might you be able to leverage some of the different kind of planning instruments that we all kind of work with in our communities? So where the intersection points might be to say a hazard mitigation plan, and again, kind of making a shout out where we can, in this case, to Pinellas County in what they've done to incorporate kind of coastal and stormwater flooding, what they do. Really kind of thinking about this from, you know, a lot of the different, you know, trying to really hit those twofers. Where might you be able to take this information and really kind of make it standardized across various different plans? But then also kind of recognizing that as it relates to stormwater, a lot of communities are, you know, really, they respond to NPDES, you know, a lot of EPA different regulations. So how, again, you know, some things related to the Coastal Nonpoint Pollution Program through the National Coastal Zone Management Act, but then also other things, right? How can we take this and be able to really kind of make the intersection point? Again, we wanted to recognize that there's a lot of different opportunities to kind of integrate what you learn from here. And then certainly the traditional on the ground measures, green infrastructure, more built solutions, what have you, and then some funding, some things, some considerations to think about as you go through this. And then finally, at the end, this notion of kind of, you know, where are communities actually kind of working on this, and how have they been successful? Some you know, short case studies that have been developed to really kind of speak to this. That is something that we've looked through and something that we intend to grow ideally as we continue to interface with you all and other different communities. All right. So that is kind of an overview, but I've saved the real deep dive here for last. And this is the analyze section. This is what we basically just updated last year for helping communities really start to think about this notion of actually deriving a coastal total water level, and then using that to then assess how that might impact their ability to manage stormwater. So this in itself is divided into four different sections. The first one is where we help you define what a future coastal total water level scenario might include, what components might include. And this kind of allows you to kind of choose your own adventure, build your own scenario. That's important because what you do here in step one then dictates how you move through step two, which is to then take, it kind of sets the boundaries, if you will, for doing a coastal total water level derivation. Step two is really it's almost like a calculator that helps you kind of manage and that information. The step three then optionally allows you to evaluate this information against some critical elevations related to your stormwater system. And then finally, and optionally, you might evaluate your stormwater performance. But again, this is it's a linear process, and I'll show you as we get through here, it all depends on how you define your scenario as to whether or not you go through all different steps. So again, part of what we heard when we went to Hallandale Beach in 2019 was that the original kind of way in which we presented the information for this section was too overwhelming. It was just kind of a very broad, high level outline, and that we were, you know, asked to really think about how we might be able to really kind of make this more of like a customized way for folks to go through this process. And so that is what it resulted in what we have here. So again, just as what you saw with the assess section with this, if you have done an analysis in the past and you haven't cleared your browser cache, then that is available to you. This is also really helpful because it will also, you can continue that previous analysis. This is something that you know, we're going to kind of rush through a bit today, but it may be something that you may not do all in one sitting. You may have to consult with some others, and so you may want to come back to this. And so long as you haven't cleared your browser cache, then this is something you can always come back to the last spot that you were at. So it's kind of a nice feature of this product. I'm going to go ahead and clear this analysis and get started here. But before we do that, I do want to kind of talk about the setting expectations, and it kind of aligns with this first portion of the product here, which provides a lot of useful information to kind of educate and inform users on really what they're getting into when they get into this section. So again, this is why we really refer to this as a learning product. It is a workflow, and this is to be used in place of what you're gonna hear about, say later on, from the Coastal Hazard System, which is a model-based approach, right? This really kind of allows you to, in absence of a dedicated, series of models or what have you for your community, to be able to use nationally available tools and data sets to be able to estimate and drive a coastal total water level. So it's really meant to, you'll see how we're going to leverage a lot of information from that's collected at our tide gauges to be able to help kind of pull together and estimate a coastal total water level. So there's a lot that you can get just, I think, in that portion of the product in itself before you ever even get to this notion of your stormwater infrastructure. Now, it's important to note that if you really want to do this, you know, from start to finish, that you're going to need to have local knowledge of your stormwater system. It's going to be inherent, and you'll see that as we walk through this. But also note that, really to be able to get a very, kind of fine level of analysis for this product, you're going to need to have, at the end of the day, a detailed model of your stormwater system. This is not meant to take the place of a detailed model of your stormwater system. This can support stormwater modeling efforts by providing that coastal total water level that can be used as a boundary condition, as an input for doing an analysis. Then when you can run an analysis using that as a boundary condition and then modeling a precipitation event with that concurrently. But it will, for those smaller communities, and again, we wanted this to be something that could be available and applicable, not just for, say, the Tampas or St. Petersburgs or Miami-Dades, what have you, where you have a large resourced stormwater management system with a big model. We wanted the smaller communities to be able to leverage this. And so, again, we provide and you'll see the methodology to estimate potential impacts in one service area. So this can be used as something, the whole thing, again, is it's more of like it's an estimation. It's used as like a kind of a screening level to start to think about, all right, so let's put some scenarios together. Let's think about what the resulting coastal total water levels may be. Let's then compare that to some of the elevations that are critical in our community, and then start to, kind of then estimate what, a coincident rainfall event may bring at that point. And then, kind of using that as maybe a starting point. Maybe you use that information to identify, hey, I've gotten this service area, this catchment, I've got no issues. We're doing pretty good here. But maybe in the neighboring catchment, we are having some issues. And it's also important to note here that this is meant to be done in absent. If you don't have a comprehensive model of your stormwater system, then this is meant to be done kind of catchment by catchment in order to really get a more accurate and comprehensive portrayal of your community. So that's kind of all covered here in this set your expectations, assembling your team. This is something that's meant to be done by, it can be done by a single person, but really it's going to take the input and expertise of stormwater managers, maybe public works folks and the like. So this kind of really is meant to start to recognize that this is, something that's a little bit broader than just a single individual potentially. And then this notion of choosing a steady area. And again, you note this is what you're seeing here on the right side of my screen is something that is how we've set this product up to really where the user interfaces with the product on the left-hand side of the screen, and then on the right-hand side where we can provide more detailed information and guidance. Again, this is really designed to be more of a learning product than anything else. And then the last thing here is talking about identifying your data. So I wanted just to kind of note here that for the purposes of this demonstration this morning, we're going to use Hallandale Beach again. Many thanks to them for the work that the input that they provided. They're one of the folks that really are directly responsible for how this manifested itself. We're very thankful. So I'm using some of the examples that we used in the workshop itself. I'll also note I'm not a stormwater manager or engineer. We worked very hand in hand with colleagues at Atkins Global, Steve Bourne, Ken Hunu, Margaret Walton, were part of the team that supported us on this effort to really kind of bring that stormwater and coastal flood expertise to this. So just also wanted to provide credit, certainly where credit is due there. All right, so the data needs for this, this section in particular. Ideally, this is what you're going to want to kind of really think about and need here is this location of the stormwater outfall for a particular service area or catchment, right, as well as the outfall invert elevation, right? So this is information that I'm sure if you're not a stormwater manager, this is something you need to kind of, you can obtain from your stormwater manager through as-built plans or even working with them to conduct a simple survey. So having that information for a catchment is going to be really useful, as is the catchment area as well. So we use that information a little bit later on. And then finally, to really be able to recognize kind of this notion of starting to think about how that coastal total water level that you derive may impact your catchment through overtopping, then kind of having this information of what's like that lowest grade there where that overtopping could occur in your coastal facing section, the lowest grade, the length of the lowest grade elevation for a weir equation, and then finally the lowest street elevation. You'll see how that comes into play a little bit later on. I did just though want to kind of think about this. And so we're going to put this poll question up here. I'll go back to the last slide so you can think about this, but just kind of from what you've heard right there, and you see it here on the right-hand side, how easy would it be for you individually? And I recognize we've got a mix of folks here. How easy would it be for you to obtain the data elements required to carry out a full analysis in this analyzed section?
Make it hard to find your account number.
Yeah, you still have access to the My Verizon application, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
If you went really quickly, if you want to just mute your line.
Hey, Keith.
Right there on the first page. And if it's not, you can go to like the billing.
Someone's obviously.
Okay, I think we're good. Yeah.
Someone's trying to find some information there, obviously. So very easy, somewhat easy, not so easy. Again, these are your data needs. Review those just really quickly for about another 30 seconds here. And again, I'd just be curious to note, because we recognize that having this information at hand may be a bit challenging. I'd like to hear from you what you think about based on, again, knowing what we know about who the.
My current phone number is 239.
Wait, don't share that.
Actually,
you wanna...
Hey, Keith.
Yeah.
All right, I don't want to have to mute everybody, but I might have to. And then you'd have to press *6 to unmute.
Well, hopefully we'll
okay. Yeah, let me try to do that. Try to just adjust the participant. Sorry about that.
No, no worries. Technology is great when it works, and sometimes it works a little too well, right?
Yeah.
Yes. All right, wonderful. If you want to then, Kip, if you want to allow folks to answer this poll question, I'd be appreciative of you here, and then we'll continue on.
Definitely. I'm just going to share my screen, because that's the only way, unfortunately, to load the poll questions. And then poll should be open. So go ahead and answer, you know, whether it's very easy, somewhat easy, or not so easy to obtain this data that Josh just described. And we're about at 25%. So appreciate the responses, and let's try to get up to, you know, 60% if we can. And then I do have your slide. So this is the information that Josh is referring to.
Yeah. Thanks, Skip. Yep. And to get a big shout out to Kip for facilitating this so well. Appreciate you supporting us all this morning.
Thank you, Josh, and yeah, Noah and everyone else has been terrific throughout this whole effort. Almost sad that it's over. All right, gonna open those poll results. Should be able to see them. So let me know when you do.
Yep. Okay. So not a whole bunch of people, but still, I mean, a good amount here. So about six indicated it was very easy. The majority indicated that it was somewhat easy. About 15. Well, a little bit more than half of the folks who chose to answer this, and about 8 said not so easy. So yeah, and that's again what we expect. There's going to be some communities that's going to take a little while to get that data and information for this, but some, again, you know, depending on the size of the community, if you've got a model, you've got this information at hand. So important to note. All right, so let's see here. It might be helpful to have typical information about outfall. Yeah, that's thanks, Catherine, for that. That's something that we we'll make sure we buttress the information with that. We're always kind of trying to identify kind of if we've got folks who aren't stormwater managers. She basically said that it might be interesting, you might be useful to have information about the outfall and what that means for folks who may not be familiar with that, inverts, things like that. So we've tried to provide a little bit more about that, but it can be something we can always do a little bit more for and maybe supplement with some learning products. All right, so let's continue on here. Share the screen. All right, okay. So this is the data that we have from the study area that we're looking with in Hallandale Beach. So we've got the outfall invert elevation, the catchment area, the lowest grade elevation, all of this information we've got from the workshop that we did there. So we're gonna use that as we move forward. All right, so let's go on to step one here. All right, and then this is just as we walk through the tool, it provides you with kind of an overview. Again, trying to really walk you through the process as much as we can. We're gonna hit next and recognize that step one is asking you to kind of define your scenario. Now at this point, it's important to note that the way that we have designed this is to incorporate several different sources of flooding, both from inland events, so like precipitation, or it even could be riverine, as well as coastal total water level. So kind of thinking about the coastal events, the coastal side of things, tides, storm surge, waves, sea level rise. And then if there are any adaptive actions, we want this to be something that, you know, again, the feedback that we got early on was that folks said, we want to be able to do some what if scenarios. And so what we wanted to try to do here too, was to kind of think about what might be some adaptive actions that could be considered. So maybe if you don't have a tidal flap valve, or if you're thinking about implementing pumping in the future, then we have kind of designed that to be inputs and outputs into this process in itself. So again, just something to consider here. This step one is all kind of qualitative in nature, and I'll show you that in just a second, that we're not asking you to calculate anything or at this point. It is just basically to be able to kind of, you know, set the boundary, if you will, for the scenario that you're going to do here. So I'm going to click on next. I'm going to do Hallandale Beach here. This first one we're going to do is high tide flooding. So this is just kind of setting some basic values. We are going to define this first one as kind of like a future high tide flooding scenario, right? So kind of using here on the right hand side, you see this comes from the graphic from the understand section of the product. So in this case, we're going to look at, say, high tide flooding in 2050, right? So in 28 years here. In that case, then we want to consider in terms of the ocean side events that we want to look at, we want to include extreme tide. So this is kind of looking at future high tide flooding. We are going to incorporate sea level rise and choosing the scenario here on this. We are not going to include storm surge in this scenario. We will later on. We are not going to include a precipitation event. So this is important to note, right? In this case, all we're doing is we're calculating a future coastal total water level without a coincident precipitation event. So this is that setting day high tide flooding. And in this case, we do want to model a tidal flap valve. Let's say that, you know, this is something that is either in place or we know it's going to be in place in the future. So we just enter in our basic values here for this, the community service area, the starting year. And in this case, this is the scenario timeline. And again, wherever possible, we provide information in this guidance link here on the left that then brings different information here on the right. You'll see how that becomes critical a little bit later on, right? Okay, so the next step in the process is this coastal total water level determination. This is where we are going to walk you through the process of actually estimating a future coastal total water level based on what you chose in the last screen or what have you, right? This is still at step one, right? So it's this is gonna, again, kind of determine how we're going to actually define our scenarios. So if we choose set manually here, that means that basically we're just gonna enter in a water level threshold. But what's probably more meaningful for a lot is to be able to actually kind of step-by-step methodically calculate by component. So we're gonna choose to set that here. Again, we're not gonna do it just yet, but we have to kind of set that as a part of the scenario here, okay? Then again, here we're going to look at how we define different ocean side events. I'm going to go back up to the scenario here. We have chosen to include extreme tide here. Here we're going to choose a sea level rise scenario. And again, this is all important to note that this isn't doing anything other than just to kind of lay out and define the scenario that you're going to be working for. So in this case, this is, you know, we're choosing that we're going to use the intermediate high, but it's not actually doing anything in the background here, and we are going to choose not to incorporate storm surge here, as we have noted. Inland events, we could choose a precipitation event or other flow sources. Again, we'll do that in the next scenario. But we are, in terms of adaptive actions, we are going to include a tidal flap valve here as an adaptation against you know, coastal water levels impacting the system in the future. Okay, so again, as you go through this, there's a lot of information that is provided kind of on demand at the right hand side, again, to really facilitate folks going through this on their own. All right, so that is the kind of step one that we've got on here. You kind of see the linear process that's on the right hand side. we're going to move on here to step two. I'll also note, so you may notice at the top right-hand corner that there is a My Report function to this that kind of gets built as you go through this. So right now, all we've done is just basically define the scenario on here. And even some of this stuff we haven't even completely defined just yet, right? So this gets kind of built. You'll see as we go through here that you can continue to kind of build this out, and then you can print it out at the end, or again, it gets saved in your browser cache. All right, so determining the coastal total water level here, again, this is kind of allowing you to kind of take the information if you chose earlier on to calculate by components, then this is where it will set you into this notion to be able to calculate things by their component parts here. So first thing we have to do is kind of set our base elevation references here. And again, this is trying to recognize the flexibility that this has. You can choose either, feet or meters as your units, as your elevation units here. You then are asked to choose a tidal datum. We can choose, as you see the different tidal datums here, I'm going to choose mean high or high water. And then at the end of the day, we recognize that, having an elevation that is set to a tidal datum may not be, will not be directly comparable to some of the terrestrial elevations that engineers are used to working with. So we also need to define here an orthometric or land-based datum here. So you see some of them here recognizing that we have some from the Great Lakes or mean sea level, which is what we usually see, say, out in the islands or what have you in the Pacific. So this is important to kind of set this out here, because this is going to kind of tell us how we're going to a lot of times reference our water levels to, but then also to how then eventually we're going to use as the orthometric datum reference. That's going to be how we report these elevations on the other side of this analysis. So we do that here, and then it gets us into this coastal total water level calculator, right? So this is basically how we kind of, this is how we have designed this to kind of be a bit of a way for someone to be able to kind of manage the information. This is all, and this is why you rush go through step one to be able to set the boundary for this, this difference calculator that we have here, because based on what you put into your scenario, you'll note what's missing from this right now is storm surge, right? So something we chose not to include into this. So what this does is this walks you through the process of basically, going through and getting this information, in this case, from the tide gauge, the closest tide gauge that we have here, and relying on that. In this case, we're using Virginia Key down in the Miami area is the closest tide gauge, and then kind of walks you through kind of the step-by-step process for how you can then go through and get that. In the interest of time here, I've kind of captured the relevant screen captures from this, but basically here, the first thing that we're asked to do is kind of what's that relationship between the tidal datum and the orthometric data, in this case between NAV-D88 and mean high or high water in feet. So we can capture that here, and we can enter that in our calculator, right? So we've got that on here. The next thing that we have here is extreme tide. So we use highest astronomical tide or HAT as the proxy for kind of like an extreme tide here for this. So this also using the datums page coming from tides and currents for the actual station that's the closest that has the data that you're looking for, in this case, Virginia Key. Again, we set the datum here to mean high or high water, so we don't double count that same tidal orthometric relationship here, and then we get what the highest astronomical tide is on top of that. So we enter that in here. Okay. For sea level rise, there's a couple different ways that you can get this. We note that there's a lot of tools that are out there. Certainly the Army Corps of Engineers core the sea level rise calculator is one that can be leveraged. We provide guidance on that, as well as our sea level rise viewer coming from the Office for Coastal Management, where you can enter in the community's name and the gazetteer, select the local scenarios tab. Hopefully you've seen this. There's a ability then to select the tide gauge, and you can actually view by year. And so in this case, looking at intermediate high for Virginia Key 2050, this is the 2022 projections as we have defined in our scenario. Basically, looking at this, it is 1.31 feet that we're adding in here. And then there's guidance to consider kind of this notion of seasonal variation, right? So recognizing that water levels do change, we can look at that from the tide gauge, looking at the sea level trends and the average seasonal cycle. Again, information we provide through the guidance here of how you can provide that, get that information through here. And we find that basically It's about, you know, 1.59 meters or about half a foot in there. And then we provided the ability to kind of, you know, add different factors, other factors in here. If there's anything that's not accounted, then you can certainly provide that in here as a way to kind of, if you've got modeled output, something to make this a little more flexible as we go in the future. So that gives us our still water elevation. You can choose to add wave run up to this, and basically the guidance that we provide, it's an estimation of adding about 10% to this. I'm going to choose not to do it here, but it's definitely something that you could want to choose to bring into it that would certainly increase the total water level here. But what this gives me is the coastal total water level of 2.95 feet. And again, kind of estimating bringing all of these different components together. Right. So in this case, actually, I mixed the seasonal variation by just a little bit here so we can get consistent with what we've got here. And that gives us, again, looking at the components here, if we kind of think about that relationship between NAVD 88, mean higher high water, then your sea level rise, your highest astronomical tide, and any seasonal impacts, this would be kind of the worst case high tide flooding based on what we've seen, you know, from the gauge in itself and incorporating sea level rise on here, we get this coastal total water level, right? So at this point, you know, this is something that we've heard that folks have told us that, you know, there's certainly a lot of value in kind of, you know, being able to kind of find this, you know, derive this information in capturing it. So this is something where, you know, certainly at this point, even if you're not thinking about the implications on stormwater, this could provide value in helping you kind of define a scenario, coastal total water level scenario, and then being able to kind of capture that in this report. So even if you don't have information on your stormwater system, this there still is, I think, some utility here. And I'll note that we've had a good friend of ours, Lisa Auermiller from the Jacques Cousteau National Estuarine Research Reserve, is working on a use case analysis for this product. And she's been working with some folks across the country on getting more input and information. And a lot of folks are kind of talking about that there's a lot of value in kind of just this portion of what we've just done for this product that could be useful for folks as well. All right. But the next step in here is step three, which in fact, actually, before we go to that, I do have a poll question, and then we'll kind of get to the end here. How useful would this scenario-based approach to estimating a future coastal total water level be for your community? So again, recognizing this isn't a model-based approach like you're going to see with the coastal hazard system, but it does allow you to kind of step through and kind of incorporate some scenarios here. So Kip, I think this is the last poll question we have. And so if you wouldn't mind, getting folks to answer this, how useful would you find this? I'd be curious to note, just from what you've seen here, how useful this might be for your community.
Great, so yeah, poll's open, and we'll give it about, you know, 20, 30 seconds to answer. Right now we're at about 30%.
And again, you know, this is meant to kind of, you know, it's not a model based approach, and we recognize that. And part of the reason why we designed this not as an automated tool was to be able to incorporate flexibility in the future as, say, coupled models come together, as, you know, new tools like the coastal hazard system come into play. You know, we see the opportunity then to be able to provide the ability to add that information into here or to replace some of the prompts that we have in here with that kind of model based solution. All right, polling has ended, right? So yeah, those folks said this would be, you know, somewhat useful, very useful, appreciate that. I would be fine if folks say not very useful or I don't know, that's perfectly fine as well. But thank you for that. And we'll get to the end here.
Yeah, 2 seconds, I'm gonna save it. Right, all set. Thanks, Josh. About 10 minutes, but.
Yep, we're gonna.
Not a huge one.
Quick finish here. If I can share my screen again. Thank you, excellent, okay. So this next part is kind of how we start to think about how you can start to evaluate this against some critical elevations with your stormwater system, right? So recognizing that, as I said before, this kind of allows you, and this is kind of really neat because it actually takes this in this graphic over here on the right-hand side that you see here. It basically will, it'll change based on what you enter into here. So in this case, Our coastal total water level is 2.9 feet, NAVD 88. We know that our lowest coastal facing elevation, what I entered in before, is 4 feet. So you see how that changes the graphic here. The lowest street elevation in this case is about 2.45 feet, NAVD 88, and then the outfall elevation is about 2 feet below. Right, NAVD 88, and there is a tidal flap valve in place. And so this is just kind of a way to be able to account for and enter in this different information, again, at a very kind of basic overview level. And then what it does is it kind of takes that information, it provides you with this kind of a custom kind of assessment, right? So based off of this, you know, what are we seeing here? In this case, right, we know that the coastal total water level doesn't exceed that lowest coastal facing elevation, and there's a tidal flap valve in place. So the lowest street elevation, again, this is not considering a coincident precipitation event. So it kind of, you know, it provides you with a little bit of a custom assessment for this, and it gets captured again, you know, in this report. That you see here, which actually captures this information, puts in this graphic. So it's meant to be kind of a bit of a communication tool as well as you kind of go through this and again is saved. It can be saved out, printed out, or it can be you know, something that's saved in your browser session. Okay. So in this case, right, as we get here, there is no, we've chosen not to include a coincident precipitation event. So this takes you to the end of the assessment in itself, right? So that's kind of the first scenario. So for the second one, I just really quickly want to show you what we have here. Going back to the analyze section, I'm going to clear this analysis. I'm going to get started again. And in this case, we're going to do a different, this is going to be a future coastal storm scenario. So I can go back in here. We're going to do Allendale Beach coastal storm, same starting year. Same scenario timeline. Okay, in this case, we're going to not do extreme tide. We are going to do the highest sea level rise scenario. This is like the worst case with a 25-year storm surge return and a 10-year recurrence interval precipitation event, right? So a concurrent precipitation event, and that tidal flap valve is still there, right? So we are going to calculate by components here. We are choosing again the high sea level rise scenario. We are choosing storm surge. And again, this is where we're gonna, this is just setting out the boundaries for our analysis. So in this case, we're gonna say that we're gonna use 25 year recurrence interval, right? And then we are gonna choose to do, in this case, a 10 year precip event. So we are still going to model an adaptive action. So again, that in itself, we have now set the bounds for our scenario, okay? Here, we're gonna determine the total coastal water level once again. In this case, we're gonna use, again, the base elevation references, same as last time, moving forward here, right? In this case, I'm gonna continue forward here. So we see the tidal orthometric relationship here. We can calculate sea level rise. Here, we're going to look at the high scenario from 2022. And again, it's kind of pointed out here for us. So it's 1.54 feet, 154, 1.54. The seasonal variation, again, is something we're going to account for as well, 0.57 feet. Right. And also now, so the next thing we're adding in here is storm surge. So again, kind of looking at the return period for the in looking at the exceedance probability curves versus return period graphs, looking at the water levels for this gauge, and this is about you know, kind of, you know, estimating it here about 3 feet for this 25 year storm. Okay, we could choose to incorporate any other factors if we had like riverine flooding, any kind of other information that we may model out. We can bring that into here. This gives us this kind of still water elevation. I'm not going to incorporate wave run up again, especially with the time that we have here, right? I'm actually going to bring this down to 2.62 feet to align this with what we've got here in the graphic. Okay, and that gets us then to this new kind of coastal total water level here, right? That when we put it against the same critical elevations here, we get the lowest coastal facing elevation against 4 feet. The street elevation is 2.4. The outfall elevation is minus 2 feet. There is a tidal flat valve in place. So as you can see here, our developers got a little bit got a little ambitious with this, and you can actually see it's raining because we've chosen to model a coincident precipitation event. But now what this has resulted in is a bit of an overtopping situation, right? So this, you know, again, at this point, we know that there's an overtopping event. We've chosen a coincident precipitation event. So this will actually take us to step four, whereas the last time we didn't go to step four. This time it will do it. And so step four, it notes that there's a bit of a branching here that can occur. And this is, again, to incorporate the fact that some communities are going to have a stormwater model. And then this kind of provides information about putting this coastal total water level in as a boundary condition there. But some smaller communities may not have that. And so we provide the ability to kind of either estimate or model the stormwater performance here. So estimation is a very high level estimation that we can do. And what this results in here is another kind of calculator, right? And what we do here is provide information and guidance to kind of be able to use the rational method to both kind of estimate, in this case, precipitation-based runoff flows, as well as the estimated catchment capacity. So in this case, we're going to choose to, this is a 10-year storm. We're going to assume that the 10-year precipitation event is going to be something that the system was able to, it was designed to be able to handle here on this. And then all of this here that I'm running through very, very quickly because of the time constraints here is provided in the guidance here. So this is something that, again, you can kind of go through this on your own and kind of, be able to kind of find it. But what it does is it kind of walks you through the process. If you don't have this information at hand, you can use modelmywatershed.org to be able to find a runoff coefficient that looks at kind of the soil conditions, the slopes of the area, as well as the land cover predominantly. So we get that. And then also allows us to look to Atlas 14, recognizing again that Atlas 14 looks at the past, not at the future. And we certainly have heard a lot at NOAA about that and are kind of developing some plans for addressing that in the future. But basically walking you through the process of getting the information for the rainfall intensity there based off of that. Of that 10-year storm with a 10-minute time of concentration here. So you end up getting this this particular flow for this, in this case, the 10-year storm. And I'm going to put that in down here as the capacity, assuming that that is what this catchment was designed, the system was designed to be able to handle. Right. But then recognizing that we do have an overtopping event. So using a kind of a weir flow analysis here to be able to, and this is where that overtopping head, the elevation we can derive from the top, the lowest coastal facing elevation, and then our flood elevation, the overtopping length here that we got, kind of assuming where that weir is going to occur at the end of that catchment, and then a weir coefficient. All of this, again, is information we provide, some guidance in over here on the right-hand side. So again, estimating this as around 300 CFS on top of that. So there's your total inflows. If you have pumping and you can quantify that through outflows, you can add that here. And then basically what you get here is the estimated flows through just this catchment. And then basically, again, comparing it to the catchment capacity. So what you get here is this kind of, all right, so we've got, here's your coastal water level. Here's a coincident precipitation event. Here's the flows at that point. All of that, again, kind of gets, added to this document now. Which has been kind of completed as a part of this analysis to kind of both look at the coastal flooding, that impact assessment, estimated stormwater flows. Again, recognizing this is for much smaller communities, just as a high level look at, hey, where might you have some issues in the future? All of these things considered, it is not a replacement for to get the real fidelity you would need in terms of timing, duration. You'd need to have a stormwater model. But again, trying to provide that information for smaller communities that may not have that just want to start to think about, all right, where, catchment by catchment, where might I see some issues in what I'm working through as well. So it's a lot to go through. I appreciate everyone's patience this morning as we've worked through this. This is the URL for the product. Kip has put it in the chat. It's also on our Digital Coast platform. Again, this is a learning product, so we have it in the Digital Coast Academy as a part of our training section and the guides and how-to section on here. This is my contact information. I'll put it in the chat. I know that we're getting ready to, I've used all of my time and maybe one more minute. So if you have questions on this, you know, feel free to shoot me an email or put them in the chat. I'll be here and try to answer as many of them as I can on that. But thank you for your time this morning, for your attention, and looking forward to hearing from you all about this product in the future as well. And Kip, thanks for the opportunity and for facilitating this.
Awesome. What a great presentation, Josh. You know, I know I certainly learned a lot. I'm going through that analyze section. It is amazing how customizable that is and all those different considerations that it looks at. So very, very neat. We are, you know, right up butting up against that time. We do maybe have time for one question. But like Josh said, he'll be sticking around. So if you have questions, please put them in the chat and he can answer. And we are at the point of our break. So with that, let's take a 12-minute break. Let's do 12 minutes and we'll return at 10:45. So it's 10:32 right now, so I guess 13 minutes, but you get the idea. So we'll take a 12-minute break, return at 10:45. Use that time, get a fresh cup of coffee, maybe check your emails, and be ready to, you know, dive into the coastal hazard system right when we get back. But yeah, thanks everybody for, you know, staying on, and thanks again, Josh, for that great presentation, and getting some kudos in the chat for that. So thanks everybody for that, and we'll talk to everybody soon. All right, I got 10:45, and we still have a lot of good stuff to cover, so we're just going to jump right back into it. So thank you, Josh, again for that great presentation on the new stormwater tool. And now we'll, you know, originally on the schedule we had the coastal hazard system first, and Drew Cotton was able to get his power back, so we're ready to go. You know, and thanks again, Josh, for being able to switch on the fly like that. But now, so we, during the regional workshop, we discussed several SACS key products. One of those covered was this coastal hazard system. We just did a brief, you know, 30-minute high-level overview of it. But now we're gonna take over an hour and really start to dive into some of the intricacies of it, the technical components, how it can be used for modeling inputs and application purposes. So this slide is just a brief refresher on what the South Atlantic Coastal Study is. And with that, I'm just going to pass it straight to Dr. Drew Condon with the Army Corps of Engineers to go over the coastal hazard system. Drew?
All right. Thank you, Kip. Good morning, everyone. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. And thanks to Josh and Kip for being flexible this morning. Certainly was unexpected. I had a FPL pull up to my house about half hour before we were supposed to get started to tell me they had to change out some equipment and I would have no power. So thankfully they worked quick and everything's back restored. So apologies if you were trying to get on earlier to see this, but thanks for sticking around. So this morning, I'm going to talk to you about the coastal hazard system. This is a key product coming out of SACS. It was developed by our engineering research and development center, the Coastal Hydraulics Lab at ERDC. And it is something that is continually being developed with new tools, new regions, updates, things like that. But for the first time, we do have coverage of the system throughout the Southeast, including the state of Florida, which is what I will focus on today. So just a outline of the presentation. We'll go over the applicability of the tool. We'll give you a real good overview and get into a little bit more of the nuts and bolts of the development that we did in the previous talk, and then get into the applied exercises, which I think is why most people are here, and then a couple of links at the end just to finish things up. A couple of these slides you'll notice are kind of repeats. But this is a real good overview slide that we presented earlier, and it gives you kind of everything you need to know about the tool, how to access it, what it does. So it provides a consistent assessment of coastal hazards caused by storm surge and wave attack under current day and future sea levels across our South Atlantic division, which is North Carolina to Florida. And then around Florida to Mississippi, including Puerto Rico and the U.S. Virgin Islands. So most of the Gulf of Mexico coast and all the Southeast, you know, Atlantic coast. The web access is given here. That's that main CHS web service page. And we also have an inundation viewer that we developed for the state of Florida, and we'll look at that a little bit later on. But that's kind of unique to the state of Florida. We've developed a couple one-offs for other studies, but we don't have that same view and capability elsewhere at this point. The input to CHS is high fidelity hydrodynamic and wave modeling, and I'll go into that a little bit. And that's, I mean, that there's a whole lot there, but we'll just kind of give it touch on that and get in a little bit more detail on what some of the inputs were. The output is, of course, what's available out on the website, and that's time series and peak water level values of the model results, annual exceedance frequencies, and these are for thousands of state points throughout the state of Florida, and thousands more throughout the Southeast. And the data is available both at current day and to future sea levels. So again, we'll look at that when we get there. This data all came online in the last year. Any, you know, modern web viewer, web browser will work. And the, I guess the biggest caveat to using the data is that, you know, these are regional scale assessments. So you'll see as we get in, it was broken up into 3 regions for the whole Southeast coast, a Gulf of Mexico region, Southeast Atlantic region, then region for Puerto Rico and U.S. Virgin Islands. So at that scale, we get down to a resolution of the models somewhere around about 30 meters or so, which, you know, it's kind of a compromise between high resolution and just having to have good resolution throughout the entire Southeast. So that's probably the one caveat, is that you do have to keep in mind it's a regional scale assessment. So if you are really interested in, you know, some levee that's, you know, up a canal far away from the open coast, coastal hazard system can still help you get there. It can help provide boundary conditions for additional modeling, but you'll probably need additional modeling to get to that very specific location. So some of the key components and just an overview of what the CHS is. So it's a national scale effort. I mentioned it, we now have it for the Southeast, but it's been developed in other regions prior to the Southeast. And it provides the quantification of coastal storm hazards and the distribution of probabilistic coastal hazard analysis results and statistics. So the main components are the PCHA, which is that probabilistic coastal hazard analysis, a data repository, a web tool for easy access to the results, and the website, which contains all the documentation and the metadata. The PCHA, that will be discussed further, but it's really just a new framework that integrates comprehensive characterization of the regional storm climatology, advanced joint probability analysis, high resolution modeling, both atmospheric and hydrodynamic modeling, and then some cutting edge machine learning techniques and meta models. That data is all distributed through the CHS, and that includes numerical model output and hazard curves for storm surge, waves, and other components as well that come out from the modeling. And these hazard curves represent basically, it's the magnitude of the hazard as a function of the annual exceedance frequency, along with the corresponding uncertainty. So what you'll see, for example, in the previous plot, this is an example hazard curve, but you see we have the best estimate, but we also have the confidence bounds around that best estimate or 50% confidence level. So that data can be, you know, very valuable, especially in risk-based design. And the CHS basically it's a centralized location for all this data. So as you can imagine, with thousands of save points, and as you'll see, thousands of simulations, there's a whole lot of data stored. And, you know, there's always improvements to how that data can be stored and presented, and we'll see those hopefully in the future here. So just quickly, a little background on the CHS. Like I mentioned, the SACS is now, or South Atlantic Coastal Study that Kip mentioned, SACS is now available as of last year. The data is available online. Previous to that, there were a number of studies that developed the coastal hazard system in their region. These include Mississippi and Louisiana, Coastal Texas Study, a Great Lakes Study, the predecessor to the SACS, so the North Atlantic Coast Comprehensive Study, and then a focus study on Sabine de Galveston, Texas. So data for these other studies are also available online if anyone. I know this is a Florida-specific workshop, but anyone that may be working in a broader region, just as a heads up, those data are there. And one thing to note is, although there's been tweaks to the methodology along the way, you know, the basis to it, the kind of the backbone to the methodology has remained the same and consistent along the way. So from a use case, from a core perspective, if we're comparing results on the South Atlantic coast, we can have, you know, good confidence that we're doing an apples to apples comparison to something on the North Atlantic coast, because everything's derived in the same way. So it makes a lot of our lives easier with feasibility studies and things like that, where before we kind of had to come up with, you know, how do we develop a storm suite for a model? Now we have a consistent methodology. All right, so this is a good overview slide of for our specific study, the SAC, the storm climatology was basically broken up into 3 regions. As I mentioned, Puerto Rico and the U.S. Virgin Islands, the South Atlantic U.S. coast, and the northern and eastern Gulf of Mexico. Pictured here are the tracks So these are synthetic storm tracks that are modeled, and you can kind of get, well, you can see it's basically a big spaghetti plot at this point, as there between all the studies is very high coverage and a number of storms have been modeled. For our specific studies, there were 1,060 tropical cyclones, the orange tracks for the east coast of Florida, and 1,085, the cyan or bluish tracks for the Gulf Coast or the west coast of Florida that were modeled. And as I mentioned, these were modeled at both present day and 2 additional sea level change scenarios, which I'll show you in a few slides, but those are right at about 2.75 feet and about 7.35 feet of sea level change. Okay, so this again is a slide you may have seen previously, but it just illustrates the workflow for the coastal hazard system. And basically everything begins with the storm sampling. The team is really analyzing the historic climatology, the tropical record, as well as extratropicals in the region, especially more so for the east coast of Florida, but also for southwest Florida, where there can be an impact from extratropical storms as well. And they take that record and they, you know, basically define the climatology in terms of intensity of storms, size of storms, track, direction, speed, forward speeds, things along those lines. And they come up with, you know, basically a set of synthetic storms or composite or, you know, made up storms that cover the whole parameter space of what is expected in a given region. While they are doing that, there's a separate team that's developing the numerical models. This is a sea storm modeling process is what we call it here in the core. It consists of a coupled ADCERC and ST wave model. Before that, you have boundary conditions that for the waves that are provided by WaveWatch 3 model, which is a larger basin scale model. And the wind and pressure forcing or the cyclone forcing is provided by a planetary boundary layer cyclone model. So you have the first upper left basically develops all these storms based on the climatology. They hand it to the modeling team who then models these storms. As you saw in the previous slide, there's a little bit over 1,000 storms per basin. And then you get the results there in the bottom, bottom right. You basically get the modeling results, the numerical model output in terms of water levels and waves for each of the individual storms. And you combine that with the statistical work that was done in the first step to come up with annual exceedance frequencies and the confidence levels that go with those. At this stage, you have all your model results, you kind of have all your annual exceedance frequencies, and then you kind of post that data to the web through the CHS viewer. And we'll get into that there in a little bit. But there's obviously, you know, a lot of details that I've left out, but that's the general workflow. And if you're interested in, you know, a lot more of those details, we do have a series of technical reports that, you know, we can provide to get into those details. So just, I wanted to provide a little bit more context on the 2 study domains for Florida. Southeast Atlantic domain, again, this includes extratropical storms. There were 3 levels of a WaveWatch 3 model that were basically nested down to a higher resolution. The ADCERC model that was used in this region had 6.2 million nodes, at about 30 to 100 meter resolution. The digital elevation map was put together by our joint airborne LIDAR bathymetry technical center of expertise, JabalTex. So it consisted of basically the most up-to-date LIDAR and data at the time. These grids were developed fairly early in the SAC study. So this is probably LIDAR up until about 2017, 2018. Early 2018 would probably be the most up-to-date LIDAR that's included in the ASRP model. For ST Wave, that's the wave model. You can see there were 14 domains. Those are in the plot in the lower left. And they had about 150 to 200 meter resolution. And overall, there were 34,644 save point locations. So save point locations are the locations on the CHS website where you can click on and download data from. And of course, a good number of those are along the Florida East Coast. Also, you know, an important thing to discuss is the validation of the study. You don't want to just run a model without any validation, right? So the model was validated before running all the synthetic storms with the historical storms you see in the right-hand side of the screen. And I should note that those historical storms, you can also get those that data through the CHS website. So if you're specifically interested in Hurricane Andrew water levels, you can get the model results for that simulation through CHS. Gulf of Mexico is similar. In terms of WaveWatch 3, again, there were three nested domain or three levels of grids that get nested down to a highest resolution. A little bit larger ADCERC model, 7.8 million nodes. Same type of digital elevation map created by JabalTex. Similar resolution, 30 to about 100 meters. There were 13 ST wave domains, again, similar resolution. And you can see those domains are along the bottom. And just over 38,000 save point locations. It's hard to see the plot on the lower left. Each of those white dots is a save point location. So you can really see the intensity increase, of course, on the coast and in the near shore and coastal regions. And again, the validation for historical storms prior to running the model, all the validation studies were performed. Okay, so this was my example. I apologize if you heard it during the last round of talks, but kind of the why do we go look at synthetic storms? And the example for that, you know, makes the most sense, or that there's actually quite a few of these you can use, but Hurricane Michael is one that's kind of fresh in everyone's mind as it was such a devastating storm and not too long ago. You know, if you were looking at the historical record, 176 years of historical record, you would only see 19 hurricanes within 50 kilometers of the location. Only three of those reached a category 3 status. And then 2008 comes along, Hurricane Michael comes along at a category 5 at landfall. We have 15.5 foot measured storm tide, high water marks that are approximately 19 feet. And it just blows the historical record away. So, you know, the take home is that even though the historical record may say one thing, there are a number of possible storms that, you know, haven't occurred in that given location. So this probabilistic coastal hazard analysis basically considers all of those different storms. There's the kind of the backbone is the joint probability method. It's basically a method that goes back into the, 60s and 70s, but some optimal sampling techniques were developed in the wake of Hurricane Katrina. And those have basically been carried forward and improved upon over the last, 15 years, I guess. And that's kind of where we're at now. Again, storms are usually characterized by the main force and parameters, which are the track position, the track angle, the intensity, the size, and the translational speed. So tropical cyclones with Hurricane Michael's characteristics can be represented within the JPM probability space. Even though this one storm occurred in one location, we can, similar type storms are considered in other locations with the appropriate probability of occurrence or probability mass assigned to it. So the basic elements of the probabilistic analysis are given here. Again, based on the historical climatology, the frequency of tropical cyclone occurrence at a location is defined. The force and parameters discussed on the previous slide are fitted to a probability distribution or distributions for each of the parameters, I should say. And then through optimal selection techniques, a set of synthetic storms and their weights or probabilities are developed and then modeled in a high fidelity coupled modeling system. Like previously discussed, the sea storm model and system. Finally, the integration of the response and uncertainty is undertaken to produce the hazard curve information. So this method is widely accepted at this point. This is very similar to how FEMA produces their flood maps. If you're familiar with that methodology, in fact, at the core, we work hand in hand with FEMA on a number of studies, serve as reviewers on some of their work, or under contract with them for a number of studies. So, if you're familiar with that methodology, it's similar here. This was kind of the regional approach taken, and we do also work with a variety of universities. In the space that lead to continual improvements and improvements to the overall methodology. Okay, so for SACs again, our study domain. So these are kind of just a zoom in of those tracks we presented earlier. Kind of good take home slide for what was developed and or what was simulated. You can see North Carolina, Southeast Florida, which is the two figures in the center of the page. 1,060 simulated synthetic tropical cyclones. And one thing I haven't mentioned too much, I didn't want to get into the details or bogged down in the details given the time, but so we do model these synthetic storms, and those we have direct numerical model results. Then through some meta models and machine learning, basically develop results for, in this case, 1,160,000 other storm combinations, each with an assigned weight. And that's called our augmented storm suite. And that basically just helps to define the confidence bands, helps to improve on the annual exceedance frequency curves for each of the domains. Southwest Florida, same thing, 1,085 simulated synthetic storms and about 1.25 million in the augmented suite. So that's kind of the machine learning suite, not directly simulated, numerically simulated. And the bottom two plots give you just a good picture of that overview or picture of the track density throughout the state of Florida. And one thing to keep in mind with this track density is, you know, each of these tracks, there are varying components to the storm. So a single track may have a synthetic storm at, you know, 2 or 3 or 4 different intensities and different sizes. So there's different combinations along each of the tracks. Okay, so the sea level change, this is a key component of coastal hazard system. I mentioned how the methodology is somewhat similar to FEMA, but one thing, well, two, I guess, distinctive factors is one, the ease of access to the data of the coastal hazard system, and two is the inclusion of sea level change. So it's important to note that the sea level change here is included as an initial water level in the simulation. And that's propagated through for all those simulations, all those 1,000+ simulations per basin. That initial water level is set to either 2.73 feet for sea level change 1 or 7.35 feet for sea level change 2. And that allows us to account for non-linearities of that are associated with storm surge coupled with sea level change. And I'll have a slide or two to show that in the future. Sorry, I'm having flashbacks of my power outage. Everything just surged in my house, but it appears I'm still on. I'll have a slide on the non-linearities. And where those two sea level change levels were derived from, sea level change one, the 2.73 feet came, it's associated with about 100 years on the USAID's intermediate curve. And it's also about 40 to 50 years on the USAID's high curve. And the 7.35 feet is 100 years on, under the USAID's high curve. And they provide a pretty good bound. You know, most scenarios, at least in our immediate planning horizon, tend to fall in between either present day or one of these two additional sea level change scenarios. All right, so the types of data. This is, again, a rehashed slide. Some of the, I went through it pretty fast on the last talk.
Hey, Drew, I don't know if your slide switched. At least mine isn't showing it switched. It's still on the sea level change slide.
Okay, maybe
I'm not sure
my power worse than thought. Can you, Kip, can you,
I can share it. Would you like without you?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. I'm trying to, I guess my modem must have reset when there was that little surge, so
all good. Let me I'll get it up and hopefully by the time the live demo comes, it'll be up and running.
Yeah, hopefully it resets here quick.
Okay. Can you see the slide, Drew?
I can't, but if you have it up, that's good. I can speak to
it. It's up, sorry. It's types of data slides up.
Okay, yeah, so again, the data slide is just the stuff in the red box there is meant to highlight what it is or will soon be available on the CHS website. The stuff outside that box is stuff that we hope to someday add. But for the ADCERC model, there's the water elevation, the wind, current and pressure information, ST wave, we have the wave height, direction, period. And within the statistics, the annual exceedance frequencies are kind of the biggest thing there. And we'll get into that in the demo with the plots and both those are both available in terms of plots and worksheet or spreadsheets, Excel spreadsheets. Can you go to the next slide?
Yep, it's on the types of data slide too.
Okay, yeah, and this is just an example. One of the things that is we've developed here for the state of Florida is the nodal water level viewer. And you can see on this slide, basically we have the upper left for both Jacksonville and Miami. Those show the save point location. So that's where you can go to the CHS website and directly download data from each of those save points. On the upper right of each of these shows the ADCERC mesh, and that the mesh consists of these triangles, as you can see kind of in the offshore, and then they get smaller and smaller and more resolved as you get closer to the shore. And where all those triangles meet, we call a node. And at those nodes, we also store water level information. We've taken that information and produced the water level viewer for the state of Florida. Now, we've only done it for a couple of the AEP values and for a couple of, or well, for all three sea level change scenarios, present day plus the two future, but only for a few of the AEP or annual exceedance probability or frequency values. And as you can tell, if you kind of put a map together, the bottom plots are more just to show the elevation data and things along those lines. But if you put a map together using just the save points, it's not going to look very good. It's not going to be, you'll have, you know, big discrepancies between save points and overland and that, where using the nodal data provides a much more resolved or higher quality map and product. I guess the one thing we can't do with the nodal data is you can see how many nodes there are. I talked about, you know, millions of nodes per ADCERC grid. So we can't store time series of water levels and all that at each one, but we do store the max water level elevation, which is used to make the annual exceedance frequency plot. So those are, you know, a nice key product that we'll walk through for Florida. With that, I think I'll pause here on this part. I'm going to check my modem, Kip, while you do the poll question, and hopefully I can log back on. I think I'm on. It looks like I'm back on, so let me reconnect.
Yeah, that's a good plan, Drew. So yeah, you should see a poll question open up. There are three questions all in one. So we'll spend about, you know, a minute or two on this one to try to get answers for all three. Since Drew is kind of getting his internet, I'll just talk through these. So the first one is true or false. All three of them are true or false. First one, CHS is only available for the Florida coast. A is true, B is false. So that's question number one. Is it just Florida or is it available in other places in the division or around the country? Number two, true or false. CHS provides annual exceedance frequency data at thousands of save point locations, true or false? And then the third one, another true and false, AEF hazard curves, peaks, and time series data are all available from CHS. We'll give it another, you know, few seconds and try to answer all three of those questions if you can. It looks like we have about 42% who finished, so we can do better than that. Let's try to get up to at least 60 if we can. Drew, any word on your internet?
Your video came back on. I think I'm back. It's been an adventure this morning.
Yeah. made it work. So.
These are all should be fairly easy. They're just meant to make sure everyone's paying attention.
Yeah. Okay, we're at 50%. I'm going to go ahead and close it. And then you should be able to see the results.
Let's see. It's only available, false, that's correct. We are, CHS is available pretty much everywhere at this point. Provides annual cadence frequencies at thousands, that is true. And the hazard curves, peaks, and time series data are available from CHS. That is true as well. And that's the data we'll get into here in the last about 40 minutes or so. So let me get.
Yeah, I was able to save it. So take the screen back if you can, Drew.
All right.
And then, I put the links to both the CHS website through ERDC and the CHS web viewer developed through SACS in the chat. So we'll start kind of diving into those over these applied exercises coming up if you want to follow along.
Okay. How's that look, Kip? If not, I can make the webpage full screen if it's too much.
I think I'm able to read it. So I think we're good to go. But okay. if anyone has trouble reading it, just let me know in the chat.
Okay. So yeah, I put the slides that you all have to the side here. And we have the website over here. So this, we're going to walk through an example kind of similar to our East Coast workshop, but add a little bit to it. Again, Kip put the link into the web, into the chat there. And we can access the CHS website either through the SACS website or through the link here directly. The chs.erdc.dren.mil. So if we go to the site, one of the newer features is to be able to determine or query your data by location. So we're going to go ahead and do that here today. So we'll click on location. Next step that comes up is kind of a login page. And at this time, everyone's a guest user. So we'll click on guest user. I'll probably have to go to full screen here, I think, to get everything. I'll catch up on the other set of slides. So we'll have a page like this open up. Here's our disclaimer. Basically, the disclaimer is telling us that, you know, this is a regional study. It's the responsibility of the user to assess the data accuracy and all that stuff. So it's standard standard disclaimer language. So this is a little different than how I presented last time. But last time you would select your study, South Atlantic, and then kind of zoom in. At this point, we can now select our area of interest. So for this presentation, I was going to look at an area offshore Patrick Air Force Base or Space Force Base in Brevard County. And say I'm interested in shoreline change or dune heights in that area and want to, you know, do some type of additional modeling in that area to get the shoreline response due to a number of storms. So I can now enter a lat long that I'm interested in. In this case, I'm entering 28.25 minus 80.60 for longitude, where I cut this radius down to about 2 miles from 25 miles, and I'm going to hit search. and it's pretty quick. Brings me right to my area of interest. I can kind of see my location, where I searched, and now it will tell me what studies, data is available for. As I mentioned, at this point, I think Texas is the only state, or Texas and Mississippi both have multiple studies available, but for us, it's going to just be the South Atlantic Coastal Study. So we'll select that. It will spin for a second, and it should populate my save points within a 2-mile radius. So we can zoom in a little more. So here are the save points within 2 miles of my given lat long. You can see there's a lot right along the coast. A lot back in the Banana River, again, right along the coast, and then they kind of get a little bit less density away from the coast, with a few overland as well. So in this study, well, there's a couple, before I move forward, there's a couple of ways we can get data. Up in the upper right, we can select on a single point with the arrow. And you hover over it, it will tell you what point you have. You can select it, and it gives you some options. We can select multiple points with either a polygon, a rectangle, or a circle. In this case, I want to provide, say I'm interested in shoreline response, usually we'll provide a run a what's called a shoreline change model, which is basically takes a transect from offshore, onshore, propagates waves and water levels onshore, and predicts how the beach space will change as a result of it. So I'm going to take this one offshore point kind of as my example point. This is point 25183 if you're following along. And so what pops up here kind of gives me an idea of what data is available. For annual exceedance frequencies, I have wave data, wave height, water level, wave period, and this is at base conditions plus the 2 sea level change scenarios. The little plot tells me there's a plot available. So I can click on that, and a plot of annual exceedance frequency versus significant wave height comes up. And the little table tells me there's an Excel file that I can download. You can get a table right here, or you can download it, and we'll go through the data download in a second here. So that's available for each of these components. Again, HMO is our mean of wave height, 0 moments wave height, still water level, and our peak wave period. There's also conditional probability data, or conditional annual exceedance frequency data. This is our wave height and our wave period, and the condition these are determined is at conditioned on the peak still water level. So this is your annual exceedance frequency of your wave height dependent on peak still water level, or at the time of the peak still water level. ADSERC results, again, these are available for a couple other conditions as well, the historic troughs, and then a few other, the base conditions with tides. Same with ST wave. This gives us our direction, height, water level, period, and geez, I should have looked up that. I think that's the wind that's input into the model. And then some of the details. on the Save Point location. So this is at Cirque Save Point 25183 ST Wave Save Point this, and then everything else that's associated with it. So what we're going to do is we're going to hit this big arrow to download data. And I should mention along the way, they do have this instructions bar, which kind of gives you hints along the way if you ever get stuck. So feel free to use that. So at this point, this is, we're just selecting which save point we want. We used our mouse arrow to select a single save point. So we only have one. If we use one of these other tools and selected multiple save points, they would all be listed here, and we would either just individually choose the ones we want, or select this upper left arrow to select them all. And we're going to switch over to downloads. And now we have all the data that's available. We can go through this and filter it if we want. Previously, we had filtered by attribute. And when we were in our earlier workshops, we just looked at the statistics data. Here, we're going to use all the data. We can further refine this if we want. I'm just, at this point, I think in the interest of time, I'll probably select it all, but we can filter by storm type. So this tropical, historic, extratropical, historic, tropical, synthetic. CC was, now I'm stumped on CC. That might be, there's also readmes that we'll get into that go over the naming convention and that CC is statistics for combined tropical extratropical. Okay. And I'll show you those readmes once we get there. So we can filter the data if we want. In this case, we'll select all. We can filter the results. So basically, we have AdSerc, our AdSerc results, time series and peaks, the annual exceedance frequencies, the conditional frequencies as well. And condition, whether it's the base conditions, the base plus the sea level change one, sea level change true, base with tides, or the tropical historic. But if we're interested in all, if we just want to get it all and then figure out what we want to use later, we can, again, select it all. We can download it either as an H5 file, which is kind of compressed binary format, like a NetCDF type format, or if we just want spreadsheets, which are easier to work in sometimes, we can do it as a CSV. Again, 44 files is telling me it might take a little while, but I'm going to click OK. And at this point, I'm going to switch over to my downloaded files. So it will take a little bit to download those files, but once you download it, it will be a zip file. You'll unzip it, and it will look something like this inside. That didn't really help much. First thing you can do is pull up those two README files. I definitely think you should explore these. So this goes over the naming convention, and there is a unique naming convention for each one. There's a first identifier for which study it was, an identifier for the type of the storm type, the tropical synthetic or the historical ones. Next identifier is for the simulation, so there's base, conditions, base conditions plus a random tide, base plus a historical tide, base plus sea level change one, base plus sea level change two. Next identifier is the post-processing. So again, this is actually specific, I think, to the NACS, that README portion. But also we have save point location, model, whether it's ADCERC or ST wave, times, what type of data it is, whether it's a time series peaks data. Some of these others we don't yet have available for the Southeast Atlantic, but we will at some point. And then the type of the file extension. And also a good thing, a good summary is the metadata, which is the second one of these README files, or I guess the first one listed here is the metadata. And this gives you an idea for each study. So if we're interested in phase two, which was North Carolina and Southeast, so the East Coast of Florida, gives us what storm types were modeled, what were the conditions. So these are the conditions we have. Here's our sea level change values, the vertical datum used, derrick adjustments. So this is just an input into the ADCERC model at the beginning based on water level, initial condition water levels, what historical storms were modeled, what extratropical storms were modeled, or the dates and times of those, ST wave grid parameters, and I think that's it. Yeah, that's it. Same thing for the West Coast. So again, those two README files are there. But let me get back to the exercise. One other thing is the plot. So in the little example I had, what our objective was to come up with a response-based analysis for a couple annual exceedance frequencies of the shoreline response. So we're not going to get all the way to the shoreline response, but we'll get to prepping a model for that analysis. So first thing, we can look at our annual exceedance frequency curve. And you know, this is a good visualization. It's good to put in a report or something like that, but it doesn't really give us the numbers we need. So rather than look at the plots, we'll back up. We've looked at README, we looked at plots quick, we'll go into CSV. So these are all those files we downloaded. And they're, again, following the naming convention. We have the historical extratropicals. We have our tropical simulated. We have the combined, and I think that's all I took at this point. I think in the demo, I might have taken more, but so we're gonna, the combined are our annual exceedance frequencies. We're gonna take a look at basically the values that made up that plot. So this top one, there are our simulation, baseline simulation, so no sea level change, annual exceedance frequencies. And I have that up already. And this, you can follow along with the slide deck, but this is what that plot, what that spreadsheet looks like, other than the highlights, which I've added to correspond with the PowerPoint. But basically it gives us our save point ID, our lat long, our vertical datum, which is really only applicable to the still water level, and then our annual exceedance frequency values. So these are years to the minus one, our parameter, our units, and then our best estimate, and then our confidence bounds, basically. So in our example, we were looking at a 2-year event, right, 0.5, a 10-year event, a 50-year event, 100-year event and a 1,000-year event, if we follow along. So kind of advance this just to keep us on the same page. Yeah, so these are the events. And what we can do is we can pull these values right out of our spreadsheet into a table, and we'll have those for a given annual exceedance frequency. So, my data just downloaded now. So if you guys were following along, yours might have downloaded as well and popped up. This is my zip file that just became available. So we have our annual exceedance frequency and our return period, and we pull these values directly from that AEF spreadsheet. So with those values, we can then, for example, for a cross-shore change model, for overtop analysis, anything like that, you kind of want a time series of data. So we want to get to a time series of data that we can input into our model. We now have values that correspond to a given annual exceedance frequency. So next we'll go look at the peak data to help identify storms. So this is our peak data for ST wave. So this is the wave component, and again in our directory it ends in peaks, and it's here. This is just for tropical cyclones. We have another file for exotrops, but there's much more data in the tropical file, so we'll work with those. We could simulate exotrops as well, but working with this, what I've done is I've gone through this. So this has every storm that occurred. If for some reason, I don't know the reason, they do start at 65, but it goes through to, in this case, 1700. So this includes all of our simulated storms, and we have a timestamp. We have our save point lat long, then our save point depth has been added. We have our significant, so these are our peak value for each of these components is now output. Significant wave height, we know, and actually mean wave period, but I'm going to focus on the wave height here. We pulled already the annual exceedance frequency values, right, in the previous step. So we go back. We know our annual exceedance 0.5 is somewhere around 4.22 feet. So we can go find storms that correspond to that. Let me do the same for still water level, because we usually talk in terms of still water level. We can do it in waves or still water level. This is still water level. Excuse me, that's still at ST wave. That's still ST wave. I'll get it. Here we go. We can do the same in terms of still water level. Here you see we have water elevation, atmospheric pressure, depth average, velocity. So we also have the velocity data from ADSERC, which can be valuable for certain types of analysis. But what I've done here is basically I've looked in this peaks data and this water elevation column and tried to find storms that line up with those annual exceedance frequencies. So in this case, I've identified storm number 454 is about 1.39 meters. And if we go back to our table, the 1.39, 1.4 meters. So this is about my 10-year storm right here. And we can go through that for, given annual exceedance frequencies, come up with a storm ID for each of those which we've done here, based on the peaks data, and then we'll want to pull time series for each of those. So the final step here is to jump into our time series. We'll do SD Wave or AdCirc. If we click on this time series file for AdCirc, we now have a storm ID that we know. We can tie that storm ID back to a given annual exceedance frequency. And this is a very large file in Excel. But this again has those same components, but this is a time series. So let me scroll down to 454, that one storm. Okay. Scroll up to the top. So again, the way this file set up, it's just storm after storm, time series of events. This date timestamp, we can expand this. Actually, is a full year date timestamp as listed. So we have the time step in the how the water level basically increases throughout our time series. And we can pull that out again for each of our storms. And this is kind of an additional step, but I pulled out each of those storms, put them in each of those time series, and basically put them here in this chart. So we can see basically what we've gotten from the CHS at this point. Is we got our annual exceedance frequencies for our point. We use that to identify storms that meet those annual exceedance frequencies. And then we went and pulled the time series of data for those annual exceedance frequencies. We can see them plotted here. What we would do next, let me show you, we also have the wave data as well. Typically the wave data is not saved as long as the AdCirc data. The AdCirc grid extends much further away from the coast, so the wave data is only saved when the storm's basically in that little wave domain. So it's usually a smaller snapshot. So sometimes there's additional post-processing that needs to be done to kind of sync up the time series to the same length if your next input, if your next model or whatever you're using needs it. Essentially, we now have time series for each of our storms, for wave height, wave period, which I haven't shown, but still water level. And then these are kind of the common components that we use for input into, for example, a shoreline change model, or as boundary conditions for another 2D or even 3D hydrodynamic model, for an overtop and analysis, runoff analysis, anything like that. We now have storms and time series of data we can use. Looking at these time series, if I were to run a model, I might run like a quick smoothing code over some of this just to smooth it out, because sometimes the model results can be a little wiggly, for lack of a better word, especially on the backside of these peaks and stuff like that. So that could cause problems, but that's just a quick overview of how to take this data and get it to a format that now we can go and run another model or run a more detailed analysis based on it. I'm going to switch quickly in my last 10 minutes to our CHS viewer. So this was, and let me advance my slide. Oh, yeah. One other important thing, sorry, quickly to talk about were the nonlinear, the effects of nonlinear impacts. I mentioned this in the talk, adding the sea level change, and I mentioned this previously, but I really want to emphasize it. THS includes the sea level change in the initial conditions to the simulation. So that 2.73 feet of sea level change is incorporated in the runs and carried through throughout the analysis. It's not the same. It's not just the base conditions run and then we add 2.73 feet at the end. And what that does is it details some of these nonlinear effects. So here we have the coastline, open coast, offshore. Their nonlinear effects are usually pretty small. We get into Port Canaveral in this case, and we actually see a nonlinear decrease of about almost half a foot. Contrary to that, in the back bay here, I think it's what, Mosquito Lagoon, we see a nonlinear increase of about 2/3 of a foot. And if you're on the West Coast webinar in Pensacola, we saw a nonlinear increase of over 1 foot. So basically, I mean, the way to think about it without, you know, getting too detailed is if you look at a tidal elevation offshore, it's fairly consistent in any given direction, north-south, right, for a fair amount of distance. Once you get inshore, that tide modulates a lot based on the bathymetry, based on a number, the topography, bathymetry, the shoreline, a number of things. And so does surge, and in this case, the nonlinear interaction of surge and sea level change. So these effects can be important, especially for higher sea level change scenarios, I guess is kind of the key takeaway there. Okay, quickly, the second viewer, second application is our viewer. This link is not the nicest to remember. It's in the presentation, so you'll have access to it. It takes you right to Charlotte Harbor to begin with. We're just going to jump over to Patrick Air Force Base just for consistency. I guess we could have stayed in Charlotte Harbor. Layers, there's a number of layers we can play with in this viewer. Depth and low-lying areas. Low-lying areas are derived in the same, using the same methodology that the NOAA sea level change viewer or sea level rise viewer uses. And those are depicted in green. So we have some here within Patrick Space Force Base. I keep saying Air Force Base. You can kind of see those. Oftentimes in Florida, you notice they're in golf courses and lakes and retention ponds, things like that. So we can toggle on different depths. We have our, so the depths that are available are our 10-year return period, 50-year return period, 100-year return period, 500-year. And those are available for sea level change 0, sea level change 1, and sea level change 2. So 0 is our base conditions, our present day sea level. Sea level change 1 is at 2.73 feet, and sea level change 2 is our 7.35 feet. So, for example, our 100-year inundation or depths with 2.73 feet of sea level change does not look great at Patrick Air Force Base. Actually, much of the Barrier Island, it does not look great. And that, of course, will increase if we toggle to the, you know, sea level change 2 in the 500-year scenario. What can we do with this data? Just quickly, in my last 4 minutes, we did a study using this data in Camden County, Georgia. So we extracted a small set of the overall NOTO data just for Camden. This was actually kind of our, our test case, and we to figure out how to put all that data Florida into the viewer, we started with a small section here because there was an interest and there was funding for this study. And basically we used that to overlay, you know, important roads, infrastructure, you know, firehouses, all that stuff, and develop a little bit of a summary report for them. So, you know, let me just get to some of these plots. These plots kind of give you an idea of, for example, impacted roads for given 10% annual exceedance probability throughout the area, 1% annual exceedance probability. So, and then everything's just kind of compiled in, you know, table form in that. So this type of, at this point, we haven't made the nodal data publicly shareable or downloadable yet. I don't know if actually any of the SACs key products are until the report is finalized, which is coming up in a few months here, this by the end of this summer, I believe. But at that point, you know, this data should be available for, you know, the public to do pretty similar type GIS analysis. So this is nothing more than overlaying our inundation data with, you know, various featured data for critical infrastructure and roads and evacuation routes, things of that nature. So that is, you know, something that will be out there soon. You can play around with the map just as a really good visualization tool of the CHS result. And it gives you, you know, a real good first look before you get into the details of the actual CHS web portal. And I think I've used about all my time. I think that's all I have. There are some, so at the bottom of the CHS page, the initial landing page, there's a little box that looks like this, says updates. Some publications get posted there. There's library that has a number of publications. There's a help link. So all that's available online, or you can reach out to the CHS team and they'll help you out with any data access and that. And I think I'm done. Thank you. Sorry, I don't think I have much time for questions unless you all want to stick around. I can stick around, but.
Awesome. Thanks, Drew. That great presentation. We are right at 12, so if you do have to drop, no hard feelings, but we are going to stick around for questions. And then I just have a couple, couple closing slides, so I'm going to share my screen here. So we shared that. So first, I just want to emphasize, you know, that this product, it's not that traditional, that bathtub model, as Drew said. It took those scenarios and identified those nonlinear, effects, combining both, you know, surge and wave components to get those probabilistic water levels. And especially with that CHS viewer, that viewer is only available to Florida at this time. It was developed for the purposes of this workshop. So really cool that the state has that those data, those maps to visualize the depths of flooding, and then being able to toggle on and off the different probabilities and different sea level scenarios can really identify, you know, how those water levels change depending on the scenarios. And as you mentioned, that link is a little bit cumbersome. So there is one more way to get this data. So if you go to the SACS website, click on GeoPortal, and then once the GeoPortal pops up, you can click on state and territory appendices, and then you'll be able to click on the Florida GeoPortal, and all those CHS layers for those, the 10, 50, 100, 500 year, for those three sea level rise scenarios are available in the GeoPortal on those map visualizations. So you can also access it through there along with all this other SACS data listed on the screen. So just wanted to point that out if you, for some reason, forget the link or just want another way to kind of get to that data. So in closing, this is the final, the final day of the workshop for this overall effort. So we really appreciate all the participation and attendance and interest. We hope it was helpful for everybody. We have recorded all these, and we will be posting both the presentations and the recordings to the Silver Jackets website. And I'll put this in the chat momentarily. So there are three presentations, the Gulf Coast, Atlantic Coast, and the technical workshop today that we'll post. And then the 7 recordings, so 3 from each of the Atlantic and Gulf Coast workshops, and then the 1-day technical workshop today will be posted within the next few weeks. So we'll send out an email when that happens, and you can go back and rewatch or just kind of fast forward to the part that you may have missed. And then finally, just want to give a big thanks to all our partners for this effort. The logos are shown on the screen, between the state and federal partners. This is a great collaboration. Really appreciated all the coordination and teamwork that went into this effort. And we really hope it had some value for all of you out there. And then one final note is that there are training credits available. Jennifer Carver just put in the chat a link to the AICP website. So be sure to check that out. There are also continuing education credits available for certified floodplain managers. So we'll be sending those out within the next couple weeks as well. So just be patient with those. We'll get them to you. We're using the attendance to kind of track that. Those will be coming soon. And, at this point, we'll take any questions on the CHS for Drew, if there are any. Yeah. Chat. Drew, have you seen anything in the chat? Oh, there you go. Is the Camden County report available for review?
Yeah, I'll check on that one with the, I think it should be, but I'll check with the project manager on that, make sure everything's final on it. I got your email, so I'll follow up with you.
Great. Yeah, I got few more thank yous. And then Drew, can you share your email? Oh yeah, you already got that. And then the last question, is it possible to email the group links to the tools shown in these demonstrations, please? We will share this presentation and all the links are in here. And if you are interested in some of those links in the chat, you can just email me and I can send you a compiled Word document with those links. But we probably won't be posting that just to limit the amount of material that we're posting on the website. But we do have that information and please feel free to email me if you're interested in getting that compiled list of links and such. So any final questions? Just wanna say thank you so much, Drew and Josh. Not only did they present at the regional workshops, but they both presented for over an hour here, really taking a deep dive into the tools. So we really appreciate this. This recording is gonna, and presentation will be a great reference to kind of go back on if your community is looking to use some of these tools for follow-on analyses. So with that, I'll stop the recording, close out, but we'll stick around if anyone has questions, and then we'll kind of compile the chat. So thanks everyone and have a great rest of your week.